स्मेल आ रही है बर्निंग की, कुछ जल तो नहीं रहा? हाँ, यू आर
क्या
ऑल्सो स्मेलिंग द बर्निंग।
स्प्रे?
ओह ओके, इट इज अ स्प्रे नॉट अ बर्न। ओह, सो देयर वाज अ प्रायर बर्न एंड अ लैटर स्प्रे। अच्छा हाँ, तो नहीं, रेडिएटर नहीं, वो जल गया पॉइंट का, ये पॉइंट्स देखने पड़ते हैं। आगे आइए आइए, हम लोगों को दूसरे मीटिंग में जाना है, इसलिए मैंने सोचा उसको शुरुआत करते हैं।
हेलो हेलो हेलो
दूसरे भी थे फेलोज बाहर, आ गए। आइए सर, आइए, विराजिए। नमस्कार। आइए आइए, फोरम पूरा हो गया है। नमस्ते सर, नमस्ते सर, आइए बैठिए। जी हम क्यों नहीं, हम आउटडोर भी करते हैं एक मीटिंग, बहुत अच्छा रहेगा,
अच्छा
क्योंकि आवाज की थोड़ी प्रॉब्लम आएगी। हमारे पास दूसरे टाइप का भी माइक है, सो सोच सकते हैं नेक्स्ट। हालांकि एक दो प्रेजेंटेशन ही बाकी है ना, एक ही बाकी है। नहीं, राजू सर ने अपनी बैकग्राउंड बदल
क्या
दिया
बात
है, बोर हो गया एक ही बैकग्राउंड से।
जी बिल्कुल बिल्कुल, हम लोग भी बदल सकते हैं, क्यों नहीं अश्विनी जी, हमारा बैकग्राउंड बदल दो यार।
बदल
यहाँ पे है, हमारे पास कोई होगा।
सकते
कहाँ गए अश्विनी जी, बुलाइए, मुझे दिख नहीं रहा है बैकग्राउंड, इधर कहीं सेटिंग्स में होगा। देर आर सो मेनी डिफरेंट पॉसिबिलिटीज इन डिफरेंट प्रोग्राम्स। यस्टरडे आई वाज इन अ डिफरेंट प्रोग्राम कॉल्ड ब्लू जीन्स, वो भी एक प्रोग्राम है पता है, इस तरह का वेब टाइप का प्लेटफॉर्म। बैकग्राउंड बदलिए, हमारे ऑप्शंस कौन से हैं, वी आर टेकिंग लीफ आउट ऑफ प्रोफेसर राजूज बुक।
बैकग्राउंड
हाँ, इसमें ऐसे नहीं भाई, चलो बाद में आप, हाँ इसमें सेटिंग्स में जाके
ये
ना,
सही है सर,
हाँ दिखाइए कहाँ।
एक मिनट सर, मैं उस पे करता
अच्छा
हूँ,
जाने
मैं
दो, चलो लेट्स स्टार्ट।
दूसरे
सो 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 बुजी इन द चेयर एंड माय फ्रेंड प्रोफेसर चहल, वेरी हैप्पी टू यू नो से अ फ्यू वर्ड्स अबाउट हिज प्रोजेक्ट हिंदू सोशल रिफॉर्म, अ स्टडी ऑफ द फ्रेमवर्क ऑफ ज्योतिराव फुले, एन ओवरव्यू ऑफ द फाइंडिंग्स ऑफ द रिसर्च प्रोजेक्ट। नाउ एज प्रोफेसर चहल ऑलवेज सेज, वी आर वेरी गुड फ्रेंड्स बट वी हैव आर डिफरेंसेस, सो आई थिंक आई टॉक अबाउट यू नो अ फ्यू थिंग्स दैट स्ट्रक मी एंड एट द बिगिनिंग। जैसे हमने इंटरव्यू किया तब से आज तक, तो मेरे मन में वही शंकाएं आज भी है, वो ये है कि जस्ट वन और टू पॉइंट्स एंड देन आई हैव टू ज्वाइन अ मीटिंग विद द मिनिस्ट्री। तो पॉइंट यही है कि हाउ डज दिस फर्दर द डिस्कोर्स, हाउ डज दिस एड टू आर अंडरस्टैंडिंग ऑफ द 19th सेंचुरी यू नो ऑफ ज्योतिबा फुले एज वेल एज यू नो दिस होल प्रोजेक्ट ऑफ हिंदू सोशल रिफॉर्म। सो दैट वॉज माई क्वेश्चन देन, इट स्टिल रिमेन्स बिकॉज एज आई सी इट द प्रोजेक्ट इज ऑन कन्वेंशनल लाइन्स। यू नो आई एक्सप्लेन वॉट आई मीन, इट सेट्स अप एन एंटोनमी बिटवीन ब्राह्मणिक हेजेमोनिक डिस्कोर्स इन द 19th सेंचुरी एंड द ऑपोजिशन माउंटेड बाय ज्योतिबा फुले, एंड दिस वी हैव बीन हियरिंग फॉर द लास्ट मे बी 40 50 60 ईयर्स और इवन मोर, एवर सिंस यू नो ज्योतिबा फुले हिमसेल्फ रोट, मे बी मोर देन 100 ईयर्स आई शुड से। सो वॉट इज डिफरेंट नाउ, यू नो दिस वॉज माई क्वेश्चन एंड आई डोंट हैव ए सेटिस्फैक्ट्री आंसर। दैट वॉज माई फर्स्ट पॉइंट। माई सेकेंड पॉइंट वॉज द प्रोजेक्ट ऑफ सोशल रिफॉर्म, स्पेशली हिंदू सोशल रिफॉर्म इन द 19th सेंचुरी, वॉज इटसेल्फ वेरी कॉम्प्लेक्स एंड वेरी डाइवर्स, एंड डिफरेंट पार्ट्स ऑफ द कंट्री टुक अ डिफरेंट शेप एंड इट ऑल्सो हैड डिफरेंट अलाइनमेंट्स। you know, in some places it was anti-imperial as well as reformative of Hinduism. In other places it was collaborative of imperialism. It was collaborative of the colonial project, including Dr. Ambedkar. He felt that the British were a safeguard and the real revolution was within Hindu society. You know? So the you can map the social project in terms of some of these parameters, their attitude to imperialism on the one hand, on the national project on the other hand. And of course, the caste question was central. And what we sometimes fail to recognize is that almost all the social reformers were against caste as it was being practiced, from Ram Mohan Roy onwards. Dayanand Saraswati was really foremost, I think, and yet Dr. Ambedkar hardly mentions him, hardly. You know, I've trawled through the entire works of Dr. Ambedkar, and because he becomes inconvenient, if you want to portray Hindu society as unequal, which is a strategic move. You see, this is, we must always differentiate between ideological and strategic oppositions and what really obtains on the ground. Because the caste system itself functioned in a variety of ways. It was not, it cannot be reduced and hypostasized to one model. So my question to Professor Chahal is that why is he repeating the same binary? Isn't there time, hasn't the time come to reflect and renew our understanding, go back to the primary sources, see the alignment of forces at that time, and also try to contextualize our own understanding in terms of the history of thinking on this matter for more than 100 years. I think this would have been, to me, a minimum desirable contribution of a project like this. And I say this because you still have time, at least in the conclusion or in chapter, I think I find chapter 4 interesting, you know. And on chapter 4, I only wanted to say one thing, that as I was young, you know, I still am very young, I feel, the child in me is not dead. But you know, we really thought that, we believed in equality, okay? And in a way, I still do. But as I grow older and I've lived in India most of my life, I've lived abroad for about 8-10 years, but I find nobody in India wants equality. What we want is reasons for special treatment in India. Most groups, communities, or you might say political formations, are interested in the politics of competitive deprivation, which can then be translated into special entitlements. Nobody, as I know it, hardly anybody, especially collectively, individually, people may say what they want. But if you look at their politics, if you look at the basis of their agitation, whatever it is they agitate for, including our farmers now are agitating, it's always based on some special deal they want with the state. And the attempt of politics, and Professor Singh can correct me, the attempt of politics is to capture the state and use the powers of the state to grant those special privileges. You know, and the covenant, if you want to use it, people say the Indian national project is based on civic nationalism. You know, my friend Dr. Shashi Tharoor also says it. I've read his book, you know, The Battle of Belonging. But I don't see evidence of civic nationalism. We don't have one contract with the state. And even if the constitution says equality, you hardly ever see it because it's always qualified for, by something. And in the end, it becomes a very unequal system, or it becomes like George Orwell said in Animal Farm, all animals are equal, but some animals are more equal than others, you know. So competitive deprivation means that, you know, you can trace back histories. If you read the introduction to the Mandal Commission, it's an amazing document because it believes that nothing changed in India for 2000 years. It was exactly the same. But history shows us things change very much. Nothing stays the same. Entire communities have moved up and down in the social hierarchy. the Patels have moved up and down in the social hierarchy, up, 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 I would say, hardly down, you know, and the Kammas, the Reddys, and the Kapis in Kapus in Andhra Pradesh, similar communities, the Gujars, the Jats, the Marathas, you know, are now seeking deprivation. They want to be given special reservations, but they were the ruling community, you know, from Chhatrapati Shivaji onwards in certain regions of India. So the contract with the state is always, always modified by the history of deprivations, is what I'm saying. And some histories are what should I say, fabricated, because as we saw last time, the discourse of history is amenable, you know, to the same kinds of narrative building. You know, it's a clash of narratives that we are in the midst of today. So given this, where is the quest for equality? So you say we want equality, but actually it means we want special privileges. And this is where we are. So I would say that Phule's idea of Satya Dharma was far more idealistic, far more, because it was an idealistic time. And what Jyotiba and Savitribai did in the field of education in their own time was so radical, was so ahead, you know, of the possibilities of that time, that to recover that idealism, to recover that, you know, that utopian possibility of equality in today's India requires a special effort, is what I'm saying, which is not served by a reinforcement of binaries that we see here. Now, Dr. Nambiar is sitting here, and I just was struck by one thing you said. You said, how do I define corruption? And you can correct me if I heard wrong. You said, corruption is the misuse of power. I think you said that. Am I right or wrong? But then the question is, what is the justified or ethical use of power? That itself we don't define. So it's again, you know, like a dog chasing its tail. Because many people will say the justified use of power is to favor my community. The justified use of power is to support the people who elected me. I'm just giving random examples. And the justified, somebody said very, very well that, look, you know, I become an IS officer. People from my village will see me. They obviously expect me to, you know, help them. What's wrong with that expectation? You know, so is it a justified use of power or an unjustified use of power? You know, the one reason, I'll end now, the one reason we love the British, as somebody phoned me yesterday, because they were, actually that's also not true, but they were usually, you know, equally obnoxious to all Indians. Usually, but I mean, the more you read, the more you see how astute they were, you know. We believe we won freedom from the British. Look at the transfer of power documents, you know. It tells a different story, you know. It was not a revolutionary seizure of power. It was a transfer of power. You know? And transfer of power to who? To unelected representatives. In 1947, who was elected? Nehru wasn't elected. Power was transferred to the Congress. And that's why Gandhi said, bring everybody in. That's how Dr. Ambedkar, Shama Prasad Mukherjee. Because Gandhi said, let's represent all sections of the political spectrum. The first elections were held in when? 1952. After the constitution, obviously. So for 3 years, what was the legitimacy? It was that the British transferred power. That was the legitimacy. So how can we say that we drove them out? You see, there's a contradiction in what we are saying. Anyhow, so with these few words, I have high regard for my friend, Professor Chahal, and I have high expectations from him. So whatever you say in your first chapters, in your conclusion, I'm expecting something new, which I can cite. When I write on this topic, if I do, आई वॉन्ट टू से दैट हमारे अध्येता ने ये एक नई आइडिया यू नो हमको दी है उस समय को जानने की और ज्योतिबा फुले को और उनके काम को भी समझने की जो बाइनरी से थोड़ी सी आगे जाती है. थैंक यू एंड प्लीज डोंट माइंड व्हाट आई से ओके बिकॉज वी आर ऑल फ्रेंड्स एंड वी आर ऑल एकेडमिक्स फर्स्ट. यस थैंक यू सर. आई विल सिट फॉर 2 मिनट्स.
हमारी परीक्षा ली जा रही है ऊपर से सुनता
है. मेरी भी परीक्षा ली है ना आपने.
नहीं आप मेरी परीक्षा ली.
ओके बिफोर ऑल द परीक्षास लेट मी स्टार्ट प्रोसीडिंग्स. आई इनवाइट डॉक्टर चेयर टू प्रेजेंट हिज वर्क ज्योतिबा फुले and also on the topic that he has suggested, which is Hindu social reform, the framework of Jyotiba Phule. I'll just briefly, I think most people here would know about Jyotiba Phule, without even an introduction, especially in the last 20, 30 years, he's become a more a name which is familiar to most people. I myself came across Jyotiba Phule in two contexts. One was when we were studying historiography, I think Dr. Panashka mentioned that. This attempt to create a counter historiography, which is a Dalit reading of Indian history. When we read it, we sort of dismissed it. We said it doesn't make sense because empirically, obviously, it's not sustainable. And how does it work? My professor, Robla Thavan, long after we had done that course, once we were in a discussion, she explained why Jyotiba Phule's narrative of history is very central to understanding the way history is used in politics. And that is the main purpose of history writing all through, whether it is professional academic writing or history writing within framework of movements. It's actually appropriation of the past for present purposes. How it is done and what are the frameworks in which it is done, that is important to understand. Second context in which I encountered Phule was in the context of education. I've been working with government school system, and the last 30 years, government school systems have seen a Brahmanization, or I would call it reverse Brahmanization. The entire Savarna community, including the OBCs, have withdrawn from the government school system and gone for private schooling. And the government schooling system has now virtually become a preserve of the Dalits and the audiences. And I spent all my life trying to, 1 year, revive the government school system in our own way. And to grapple with the problem of underachievement of children studying. Now, why are children not achieving what they are supposed to achieve? Despite the best inputs in the government school system, despite whatever people say, they're still better than most private schools. There is a sociology of education, there is a sociology of curriculum, there is a sociology of knowledge which we are trying to put in the schools, which are actually instrumental in this. In this context, I went back to look at Phule and what he was trying to do. And that was really an eye-opener because Phule had studied exactly these issues and come up with some very down-to-earth solutions. lot of his solutions are very down to earth. You know, something like the Dalit students are voiceless. So in order to give them voice, we have to have things like, you know, what do you call that? Speaking competitions and things like elocution competitions. And some more radical solutions like the Brahmin teachers don't teach our children, so we need special schools. But even more than that, they made a transformation of what was taught in the schools. So that, I think, was the transformation of curriculum in the schools that he started. He and his wife started quite a few schools for girls, for boys, for Dalits. And these, they had a very different kind of curriculum. But most important, I think, there was an institutional understanding of education, and he started what are called the normal schools. And normal school is basically teacher training institutions. One of the earliest teacher training institutions with an alternative focus on what kind of teachers we want to make so that we have a different kind of schooling. I think Jyotiba Phule and his wife, Savitri Bai. So that is my engagement with Jyotiba Phule. Now I'll come to Dr. Chahal, and I think his introduction is, I don't have to introduce him at all. He's one of the most well-known faces in this campus. At least in all the seminars, he's had a prominent place. He's been teaching in Kurukshetra University, teaches history. He holds Jyotiba Phule chair there. But the rest you can all read up in his CV, which has been circulated. But what I consider him, what I respect him for, is that in every seminar, he comes with, I mean, he almost sits there where he sits here, and he intervenes with a very clear agenda of promoting a historical perspective, a materialist perspective, and what he calls a Ambedkarian, fully Ambedkarian perspective. And he does it, I mean, without any malice, without any prejudice, and with very open-hearted and what I would say good-natured way of telling that, you know, please open up this perspective of your thinking, which I think is very important. I mean, it can be very gentle and very convincing also. And he's always very happy when someone takes it seriously, and even if you disagree with him. And I think I have a lot to learn from this particular way he intervenes in discussions. So having said that, I invite him to speak something. And just one word, what Professor Paranjpe had said. What is new about, because Jyotiba Phule has been written about quite a lot. Nothing. I mean, his collected works are available and very well edited collected works that you can find in here. And Rosalind Ohanlon has done a volume on him, setting him in his historical context. So when a new scholar from history background comes to write about it, either we look for some new sources of information, some new way, and new frameworks of analysis. And Professor Chahal has stated in his introduction that he basically brings a new perspective, which he calls Foucault-Ambedkar perspective on 19th century reform movements, and especially Foucault. And I request him to speak. Yeah. He told me that article fashionable name is
between houses.
That's what I told
you. That's what I told you.
आ जाती
ready.
So we are going to have an interesting round. So you will take a map.
Well, my dear friends, good afternoon to all of you. Respected Chair, Mr. C.N. Subramaniam, my Honorable Director, indeed dear Director, Professor Makarand R. Paranjpe, who is in fact in due sense an academic leader, and he always give insights in every seminar, his critical insights and inputs, which are very, indeed very useful to all of us and to me also. And I said he is I said, sir, my dear Director, but don't take in the meanings as Hugo loved Daniel Defoe. So my love is for that kind. My dear friends, you know, Foucault was a, Fouillé was a social revolutionary, and indeed I am also, and Mr. Subbu is also the same, you know, come in the same, you know, identity. That's why I have requested him to chair the session. My friends, our nation recently remembered Foucault on his death anniversary on 28th November. And also the nation celebrated Indian Constitution Day on 26th November, who was a disciple of Foucault. And we are also going to अम्बेडकर का जो परिनिर्वाण दिवस है 6 दिसंबर को हम उस वो भी आ रहा है अभी. सो माई क्वेश्चन इज दैट वाई दीज टू बिल्डर्स ऑफ नेशन आर रेलेवेंट for us, and particularly I am going to deliver this presentation on Foucault. I would try to give answer to this question and also the questions raised by Professor Paranjpe in my presentation. I will come to his queries or doubts later on. Before I come to the Foucault's perspective of our framework of Hindu social reform, let me first give my reminiscences of a renowned or a towering historian who belong to my department. It is V.N. Datta. Last time Professor Paranjpe remembered this historian. So V.N. Datta used to say, I want to share two of his sayings with you. He used to say two main things. The first is that this is also of importance to Dr. Patel. He said that memoirs and autobiographies are third grade evidence of history. Dr. Patel, please note, and he didn't rely such kind of evidences. In fact, he was a true historian in the strict sense of the term. And the secondly, what he said about the qualities of a teacher. He said, "Teacher does not
does not give knowledge. Knowledge is a very vast phenomenon. He said that teacher is one who just open the windows of knowledge. It's a very important saying, which I also used to quote in my lectures also, here and there. So, in fact, this founder of our department, Mr. V.N. Dutta, gave importance to the role of teacher in society. And here I again recall Jyotirao Phule, who was also a teacher. Initially he was a teacher, and not only a school teacher. In fact, he was a great teacher. To use the words of his great advisory, Vishnu Shastra Chiplunkar, who was a Shudra world teacher. So he used these words in a sarcastic way. But no doubt he was a Shudra world teacher or a Shudra religious teacher. So the one more thing which I would like to share with you at the outset, that Jyotirao Phule was a great soul and of a such stature whom three stalwarts of our nation recognized and gave homage. These stalwarts were Ambedkar, who called him as his teacher, Gandhi, who said that I'm not Mahatma, the real Mahatma was Jyotirao Phule. And the third one is Vivekananda, who said Jyotirao Phule was real Mahatma, whose heart bleeds for the poor. So here is the person who was, you know, equally respected by the three major streams of Indian social reforms and also politics. Now, something about my treatment to the subject, which was also a question raised by our director. The new thing or the new idea which I have done is actually my approach to the whole issue. I have proposed a theory here to understand Jyotirao Phule, which nobody has, I think, have proposed. And that is, as our chair has also mentioned, I have seen Phule in a different perspective, that is Gramscian as well as Foucaultian perspective. About my hypothesis, I would also share concretely that Jyotirao Phule was actually a Luther of Hinduism. He had a very big stature, was a very big reformer. So I have compared him with Martin Luther. Phule actually started a reformation movement in Hinduism that no other reformer actually does or did. What our director was expecting from me, I think this is also the new thing, that his movement was not against, the so-called Brahminical elite. And his movement cannot be defined in terms of binaries. He was not against particular caste or communities. He was for reformation. He was for radical reformation. He was a religious radical. So, with these preliminary remarks, I would now read my presentation. The objectives of present study is to make an historical, comparative and critical analysis of the framework of Hindu social reform proposed by Jyotirao Phule a radical social reformer of 19th century Maharashtra, who visualized Hindu society free from Brahminic hegemony and exploitation. Phule showed extreme concerns for the suppressed sections of Hindu society and started a crusade against Brahminism and the slavery it imposed upon the Shudras, Ati Shudras, and women for centuries. It is pertinent to note here that while inscribing his famous historical work, Who Were the Shudras, to the memory of Jyotirao Phule, Dr. B.R. Ambedkar, the chief architect of Indian Constitution and the champion of the weaker sections in modern India, describes him as the greatest Shudra of modern India, who made the lower classes of Hindus conscious of their slavery. Please note these words, who made aware the lower classes of Hindus conscious of their slavery of the higher classes, and who preached the gospel that Indian society, Indian social democracy was more vital than independence from foreign rule, unquote. The tribute sheds sufficient light on the historical contributions of Phule in the field of Hindu social reform. His contribution could be understood by recognition of the fact that he initiated a new tradition of radical social reform in India, which was further strengthened by Ambedkar himself and later came to be known as Phule Ambedkar tradition of social reform. It can also be, you know, described Dalit Bahujan movement by scholars. Jyotirao Phule was the first public intellectual, activist, reformer and social reform revolutionary from among the non-Brahmin Hindus in modern India. He was a dynamic leader of the people associated with the little tradition in Maharashtra, which was characterized by his struggle for destroying Brahminic feudal and patriarchal orders by a radical program of achieving social reform in Hindu society. The tools used by him were not very much dissimilar to those applied by his contemporary upper caste social reformers. He founded, for instance, primary schools, wrote book after book, brought out journals and pamphlets, and mobilized the masses. But his approach was sharply different from them. Since he hailed from the lower strata of Hindu society, he naturally came out as, to apply Antonio Gramsci, Gramsci's term, an organic intellectual. In other words, his social location largely helped him to develop his perspective or approach, which was totally a ground laying and based on a perspective from below, or that of lower classes of Hindu society. So his social location was actually not a hurdle to him, it helped him to develop his unique approach, which was a perspective from below. He viewed the problem of Hindu social reform from this perspective. He also laid a foundation of envisioning an utopia for independent Republic of India, one that looks the remembrance and recreation in modern form of the kingdom of Bali Raja. Some social scientists have recently claimed that Phule, like Michel Foucault and much before him, suggested in his own way a theory of hegemony and saw a close relationship between knowledge and power. Foucault, in his power knowledge paradigm, counted all knowledge systems as regimes of truth propounded by the hegemonic powers of time. Phule also saw Brahminism as such kind of regime and hegemonic system of dominance and exploitation for monopolizing knowledge, power and privileges by a particular class, which used these to exclude, divide and dominate other groups in Hindu society. He earnestly felt the need to step out this ideology, the ideology of Brahminism, from Hinduism. This, according to G.P. Deshpande, indicates a clear understanding of him about the relation between knowledge and power much before Michel Foucault. For this end, Jyotirao Phule initiated a radical reform movement in colonial Maharashtra in accordance with his framework of Hindu social reform. In order to materialize his framework, he also launched a powerful reform movement to liberate the Shudras, Ati Shudras, from the thraldom of Brahminism. Since the theme of research is termed as Hindu social reform, let me clarify this concept. As many students of history know, this concept was first of all used by the well-known historian Charles H. Imsath, who is known for his masterpiece entitled "In Indian Nationalism and Hindu Social Reform," published in 1964. In this book, Imsath has attempted to strike in the presentation upon the various moments and specific crusades of social reform, and estimated their relevant importance for social reform movement as a whole and for modern Indian history. The stalwart historian has used the concept of Hindu social reform in a very broad, though vague, terms in his books. In his book, I have borrowed the term from him, though not in the meanings as has been explained by him. It is true that Jyotirao Phule tried to present his movement as a universal movement, because he used the term Sarvajanik Satyadharma. It was not just mere Satyadharma, it was Sarvajanik Satyadharma, that means universal religion of truth. And he also wrote a book, Sarvajanik Satyadharma Pustak. So he tried to present his movement as a universal movement through his concept of universal religion of truth. The social reform movement launched by him was mainly confined to the Hindu society. As a matter of fact, his movement was no doubt one of the toughest crusades waged by the then reformers against Hindu orthodoxy and unjust social order based on Varna Vyavastha and Brahman Dharma. Though he and also many other reformers of his times did not frequently use the term Hindu, which was actually not very popular in those days. This term Hindu was actually popularized later on. But it doesn't make any big difference, because he was fighting for the cause of the lower caste Hindus, whom he called Shudras, Atishudras. What is significant to note is that his framework of Hindu social reform was the most radical framework of his times, which was altogether different from that of the reformers of 19th century, who represented the so-called mainstream tradition of Hindu social reform. My methodological framework is, now I come to my methodology, methodological framework. It is based on an approach which I have been calling a Phule-Ambedkar-Foucault perspective. So this is my perspective, Phule-Ambedkar-Foucault perspective. My methodological premise can be described in a simple way like this. There are conflicts and contradictions in each society, and Hindu society was not an exception in this matter. These conflicts and contradictions have a material foundation in the socio-economic relations of the society. They also appear at the ideological and ideational level. Also, in Hindu society, from its earlier times until colonial era, and even beyond, the shaping of these conflicts and contradictions have been heavily structured by caste at the material level of socio-economic relations, and Brahminism at the ideological level. The colonial era saw many complexities in the historical developments in Hindu society. Though the colonialism helped the Brahmin elite to consolidate itself in many ways, it also gave new scope through education, etc., to the lower class masses. This gave birth to new conflict and contradictions in Hindu society, marked by new ideologies and movements of the lower caste Hindus against caste and Brahminism. The reform movement of Jyotirao Phule was one of the most radical movement of this type during the 19th century. We should have to acknowledge that Phule has hinted some conceptual categories like hegemony, social conflict, patriarchy, etc. Further, the use of such theories or categories offered by the thinkers like Karl Marx, Antonio Gramsci, and Michel Foucault could also be helpful for understanding, interpreting, and locating the initiatives and ideas of Phule in his historical times. Hence, we have used these terms or categories for understanding Foulet and his framework of social reform. Since Foulet did not discuss the issue or problems using modern research techniques and tools of scientific scrutiny, the interpretative approach has mainly been adopted to analyze his thoughts and ideas. In addition to introduction, an extended glossary, and a comprehensive bibliography, there are following six chapters in my monograph. Chapter one traces the historical context in which Jyotirao Phule emerged in Maharashtra in 19th century. The chapter firstly describes the polity and the society in the pre-colonial Maharashtra, which was in deteriorating state, particularly during the period of last Peshwa Bajirao II. The chapter then throws light on the social structure, including important institutions existing in rural Maharashtra during our period of study. The chapter finally discusses the process of colonization started after the advent of East India Company in 1818 and the socio-economic transitions occurred in Maharashtra up to the mid-19th century. Chapter 2 attempts to understand the making of Mahatma Phule. So here I have discussed the making, the process of Mahatma Jyotirao Phule. At the outset, the life history of Phule has been briefly sketched. Then an effort has been made to examine the inspirations, influences and factors that shaped his mind. Major writings of Phule and his insights therein have also been briefly discussed. The chapter finds out that since Phule hailed from the lower strata of Hindu society, his grounded social location, in addition to his experiences and inspirations, largely helped him emerge as an organic intellectual. Resultantly, he could develop a perspective from below for that of the downtrodden sections of Hindu society. And from this perspective, he attempted to pioneer a reformation movement in Hindu society. Chapter 3 probes the Phule's critique of Brahmanic religion and society, as well as his critical exposures of the Brahminical mythology, scriptures and theories. His attacks on the orthodoxy strategies of exploitation have also been described. It has been brought about in the chapter that since Brahminism was a system of caste slavery, so far as the Shudras and Atishudras were concerned, Phule countered, criticized and also rejected it in toto as a religion to be accepted. Chapter 4 focuses on the same framework of Hindu social reform advanced by Phule. His alternative model to Brahmanic Hinduism, particularly his Bali Raja utopia, this was actually the utopia, the first utopia by a lower caste reformer in modern India, and later Ambedkar also developed a full-fledged similar utopia. So, Phule called this utopia Bali Raja utopia. So we have discussed this utopia of India's transformation at the outset in this chapter. Phule's social and religious philosophy has also been examined in the chapter with particular reference to his idea of equality as well as the conception of Satya Dharma. The chapter reveals that Phule envisioned a popular form of reformed Hinduism, wherein he dreamt of an egalitarian and modern society based on his conception of the religion of truth. Chapter 5 describes the movement of social reform launched by Phule, especially after the founding of Satyashodhak Samaj for the upliftment of Shudras and Atishudras in 1873. It throws light on the crucial Mayer's initiatives taken by Samaj under the leadership of Phule for making a change in the socio-religio-economic code of Hindu society. The chapter explores that the Samaj tried to transform the Shudras, Atishudras into a new moral community and a pioneer agency of reformation movement in order to initiate all-round reforms in Hinduism. Finally, chapter 6, the epilogue, It is a summarized and a critical overview of the entire research work. ये मुझे यही तो नहीं हो पाएगा मेरे से इन एनी केस. तो finally, chapter 6, the epilogue, is a summarized and critical overview of the entire research work and also substantiate my major findings and hypotheses. The major conclusions of my study are as under. The Hindu religion as is described today is said to have its roots in the Vedas, the poems of Indo-European people whose incursions into Indian subcontinent took place few centuries after the earliest urban civilization in India, that is Indus Valley civilization. Hinduism has been a unique phenomena of spirituality linked to a particular way of life. Many scholars believe that it is an ancient and profound religion. It was a naturally grown up religion, although its stability had been broken from time to time by invasions and disturbances. It maintained a fair continuity also. With a core in the religious traditions, going back to the Vedas and Upanishads, it has brought forth many faiths, sects, and even religions, for instance, Jainism, Buddhism, and Sikhism, and brought out of the same fertile continuate of tradition all parts of India and Hinduism's contributions to the world. Since it was not founded by an individual prophet like other religions of the world, Christianity, Islam, or Buddhism, the element of plurality remained one of the main characteristics in Hinduism. The basic feature, I think, of Hinduism was this element of plurality, not only in ideas but also in other streams also. It was on this account that different faiths, sects, sets of beliefs, institutions, dogmas, customs, etc. emerged in Hinduism. Of them, some were not only ununiform but even contradictory to one another. As normally happens here too, the vested interests exploited the situation. So here comes the problem. Using their hegemonic position in Hindu society, the vested interest claimed the systems, beliefs, and dogmas favoring their interest to be the crux of Hinduism. The Brahman Dharma or the Brahmanic Hinduism was outcome of such state of affairs. The main themes of Brahman Dharma were the identification of orthodoxy with the acceptance of the authority of Shastras and the Brahmins, and the idea of Varnashrama Dharma, the fourfold system of caste and stages of life, and the ideal socio-religious life. As it developed, Brahminism had accounted for the emergence of an unequal Hindu social order based on Varna Vyavastha. The material base of this order lay in social economy based on the institutions of caste, jajmani, and untouchability. Treated like social invalids, Shudras and Ati Shudras were supposed by Manu to be fed and to be clothed with the remnants. With the remnants and castaways of food and clothes of the higher orders, they were not entitled to hear the Vedas or wear the sacred thread. They were kept out of all yajnas and anusthanas. This legitimized the hegemony of Brahmins and Dvijas over the lower orders of Hindu society. To Jyotiraya Phule, Brahminism expresses the superiority and privileges of Brahmins and other high castes on the one hand, and slavery and exploitation of the Shudras, Ati Shudras, on the other. The Brahminism created various barriers in society, and caste was one of them, and it was a very big barrier for Jyotiraya Phule. He he clarified, he clearly identified Brahman Dharma as a hegemonic system, which was historical, constructed over times and perpetuated, rationalized, and made sacrosanct the dominance of Brahmins, and also their ideology of social hierarchy, particularly through its strategies of disseminating knowledge, knowledge that is religious, philosophical, or secular in Hindu society. Notably, he always used the word Brahminism instead of Hinduism, which was, as G.P. Deshpande also points out, basically an ideology or system of Brahminical dominance or Brahmanache Varshchava or Brahman Varshchavad. Not only Phule, even Ambedkar, who called himself, claimed himself to be a disciple of Phule and generally regarded as an anti-Hindu, also went on to argue within quotes, I'm quoting Ambedkar, "You will succeed in saving Hinduism." So this is a very important point. "You will succeed in saving Hinduism if you kill Brahmanism." So here the same line was adopted by Ambedkar, which was actually propounded by Phule. Hence, there was nothing sacred or divine about Brahmanism, as it was based on unjust religious, social, and moral ideas. But since it presented itself as divinely ordained, it was necessary, Phule felt, to oppose this system in its entirety and dismantle it ultimately. Historians commonly believe that intellectually, Phule was greatly influenced by Thomas Paine, the English-born American religious radical and political activist who inspired patriots in American Revolution of 1773. No doubt, Paine's treatise, Rights of Man, which was called Bible of the Poor, and also his other book, namely The Age of Reason, had deep imprint on Phule's mind. But this is my proposition. But the most critical inputs was actually provided to Phule by the homegrown Shramanic and Bhakti traditions based on equality, reason, and religious radicalism, coupled with his own experiences and observations of the socio-economic realities of his times. He appeared to be a gifted scholar, and as suggested, was one of the earlier organic intellectuals of modern India. He authored many writings, which includes plays, poems, and polemical works, foremost of which are Tritiya Ratna, The Third Eye. Phule wrote in Marathi mostly. So these are his writings: Tritiya Ratna, The Third Eye, Brahmanache Kasab, that means priestcraft exposed, Gulamgiri, that means slavery, Shetkaryacha Asud, that means cultivators with God, Satsar, the essence of truth, Ishara, warning, and Asprashacha Kafir, that means untouchables, apologia, and the last one is Sarvajanik Satya Dharma Pustak, a book of universal religion of truth, etc. Phule believed that for reforming caste-ridden Hindu society, one must have to reform the Hindu religion itself. And for this purpose, a dynamically radical approach becomes a must for any genuine reformer. That is why he had to come out with such a radical approach of Hindu social reform. It is also significant to note that there was a risk of becoming anti-religious for a reformer like him in such a case. But admirably, Phule, despite his all religious radicalism, never became anti-religious or anti-Hindu. In fact, as Deshpande has pointed out, Phule hardly used the term Hinduism to criticize the wrong things in Hindu society. Actually, he referred to the term Brahmanism itself instead. We should note that Phule was first a social reformer and then a thinker. Unlike many other social reformers of his times, he was not simply a master of world craft but actively worked along with his wife Savitri Bai Phule and other associates to eradicate the social evils. He started thinking because he wanted to do something concretely for introduction of religious reformation in Hindu society. Hence, his framework of Hindu social reform was an outcome of his thought process, especially in terms of the interest of the lower caste Hindus and women whom he was especially concerned about. When we go through Phule's framework of Hindu social reform, it clearly emerges that Phule was totally committed to the annihilation of old established orders based on Brahminism and the systems like Varna Vyavastha, caste, untouchability and gender inequality, and all socio-religious traditions, customs, practices causing violation of human rights. This was the term which actually Phule used for the first time in India, human rights, in any form. It was Phule who advocated first of all in India the inter-caste marriages and other such relations for the eradication of caste inequalities. He was for equal human rights of all women and men. You know, I would like to point out that Phule always used the word women first and then used the word men. So, and he didn't use the common term Marathi Manus, or this is actually a patriarchic term or male dominated term. So, women and men. Actually, he was the first Indian advocate of human rights. He equally believed that the enlightenment of lower caste people and women was the only way to combat the social inequalities. He pointed out in the opening lines of his highly thought-provoking treatise, Shitkaryacha Asur, that means cultivators with God, Hindi mein kisan ka koda. So, in the opening lines of this treatise, he says, which I quote, Vidya bina mati geli, yani vidya bina mati gai, mati gai to gati geli, mati gai to gati gai, gati geli, mati geli to niti geli, niti geli to gati geli to vit gaya, gela, or vit gela, शुद्र धसे, वित गया तो शुद्र धसे धसाए. That means the lack of knowledge or education led to lack of wisdom, which led to lack of morals, which led to lack of progress, which led to lack of money, and which ultimately led to the smashing of Shudras. To him, the acquisition of knowledge, it should be noted that the acquisition of knowledge by the downtrodden section of Hindu society was emancipatory, and it was key to all problems of the downtrodden. So here I have used the Foucaultian perspective or his paradigm of knowledge and power. Knowledge is a must for challenging the hegemonic class and also acquiring power by the downtrodden sections. Phule also saw the subjugation of women along with that of the Shudras, Ati Shudras, as a part of larger hegemonic design and structure of relations inherent in the ideology of Brahminism. He tried to link subordination of women with a structure of relations in Hindu society that might be recognized as akin to patriarchy. It was the Phule alone who pointed out that the key problem is patriarchy, and patriarchy is part of Brahminical system. Among the 19th century social reform, Phule alone was able to stand out to Brahminical patriarchy, and his rejection of orthodox religion enabled him to adopt a radical approach to gender equality also. He wanted that the traditional family and marriage system should be changed in the light of reason and gender justice. Phule was perhaps the only reformer of modern India who felt the need of complete reformation in Hinduism. Influenced by Martin Luther and his Protestantism, Phule, through his lower caste protest movement, Phule also launched actually fully launched a protest movement of the lower classes. So through his movement, tried to provide an internal critique of Brahmic Hinduism, whereby he was preparing the Hindus to initiate reformation in their society in a new age of modernity. As against the mainstream tradition of Hindu social reform, Phule sought a complete change, a complete reformation in the old orthodox religion itself. In 1873, Phule published Gulamgiri, that is slavery, one of the most controversial and hard-hitting treatises, which was a virtual declaration of war on the Brahminism. He also provided an alternative model to Brahman Dharma. In his alternative model, he, along with other things, came out with his own idea of Satya Dharma, that is the religion of truth. In his book of religion, entitled Sarvajanik Satya Dharma Pustak, he laid down 33 principles. He laid down 33 principles. Actually, these principles are the principles of truth to be followed by everyone. To be followed by everyone, every lover of truth. These principles of truth are the crux of his idea of religion. I'm quoting his words, "Those who are followers of truth are happy human beings," unquote. This was Phule's major contribution to the religious thought. One comes across various words which means truth in different writings, in his different writings. For instance, Satya Prakash, that is light of truth. Where we can, I refer many terms related to this idea of truth. So Satya Prakash, that is light of truth. Satyodaya, that is emergence of truth. Satyaish, the truth god or godly truth. Satsar, the essence of truth. Satya Dharma, religion of truth. Satya Shodak, researcher of truth, etc. Hence, it is needless to say that his classical book of gospel truth was also written by him to propagate only and only truth. So, to Phule, the truth was religion. And to him, this truth was not a particular idea of truth. It was a scientific idea of truth. So, hence it is needless to say that his classical book of gospel truth was also written by him to propagate truth and to materialize his conception of Satya Dharma or Sarvajanik Satya Dharma. He founded in 1873 his society, which is very famous, and we know that was Satya Shodak Samaj, the Society of the Researchers of Truth. I again, you know, draw your attention to the nomenclature of this society. Society of the Researcher of Truth in Pune. The set of principles of the Samaj drew up shortly after its formation included belief in equality of all human beings. Members were exhorted to spread out truth, propagate righteous conduct among the people, and to make them aware about man's natural and human rights as well as social obligations. Significantly, it was intended to make aware of the Shudra Ati Shudra masses of the game of orthodox Brahmins and to make them free from their social slavery. A number of social religious activities were conducted by the Samaj in its earlier days under the guidance of Jyotirao Phule. Purpose of these activities was to provide an identity to the Shudras, Ati Shudras, of a new moral community for the Samaj and its new traditions and rituals as against their ideological and social adversaries, that is orthodox Brahmins. One of the traditions founded by Phule was his unique marriages. These were called Satya Shodak marriages, and these marriages were conducted by without the aid of Brahmin priests, It was a very revolutionary idea. We can't even think about this even today, that how a marriage could be conducted without a Brahmin. So, but Phule conducted, you know, hundreds of such marriages in his times, Phule as well as his followers also. So these were his the radical religious traditions founded by or initiated by Phule and his Satyashodhak somehow. Significantly, Phule also came across as an authentic and even extraordinary spokesman of the poor peasantry. This is also a very important field in which he had contributed. There was hardly anyone among his contemporary caste Hindu reformers who sincerely bothered about the lot of peasantry. But Phule was the first social activist who made agriculture and the lot of cultivators one of his central concerns. In his Shetkarya Cha Asur, that is Kisan Ka Koda, he has depicted the peasant pauperization caused by the colonial as well as Brahminic exploitation. He refers to the tolls, taxes, debts, injunctions, and rights superstitions the peasants were suffering from, and desired how the little money the cultivator had was drained away. This was the term which Phule used even before Dada Bhai Naroji. Phule actually was the first who initiated the theory, the drain theory, the drain of wealth theory, which was drained away by the cunning and selfish orthodox Brahmins, that is Bhatji. This is the term used by Phule in Marathi. Bhatji, moneylenders, that is Shetji, and government officials, that is Lotji. So he has, draw attention to the Shetji, Bhatji, Lotji nexus, which was very dangerous for the interest of peasants. He also came forward with several plans and suggestions for peasant upliftment as well as agrarian reforms and agrastic transformation in rural India, especially Maharashtra. Finally, it has been suggested in this monograph that in view of the organic insights and contributions of Phule, it definitely emerges that his framework of Hindu social reform appears to be full of potentials, which was not only significant in his times, but is also highly relevant in the present context. As we know, the issue of social reform in Hindu society is still lying unresolved and has been emerging as a burning issue in contemporary India. The existence of institutions of caste, as well with all its medieval characteristics, frequent occurrence of atrocities on the lower caste people, and increasing caste conflicting are the few small examples. Here, the father of Indian social reform, here I am using the word of Dhananjay Kir, who called him father of Indian social revolution, still and of course certainly matters, and his framework of Indian social reform is invariably relevant in India today to achieve social justice. Thank you. So, I have completed in the well in the time.
Well, yes. Very good. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much for a range of issues relating to what you have to do. I must comment on this now. I request the audience, the online audience first, as usual. In-room audience later. Any questions from the online audience?
So is there which I don't comment on it, comment chat box. Chat box कहाँ से?
अश्वनी, chat box देखना किसी का? है नहीं?
Okay, Professor Sharma.
Can we really also refer to some Indian social cultural sources to understand and get that fully? Can we really place fully in the context of the modern system or modern issue of caste in India? The third, just it's not place. The third is whether we can locate some kind of a difference between the approach of Fule and the approach of, say, Dayanand Saraswati or Buddha or Gandhi and others, because they all have prepared or worked for the social reforms, including as the director was saying in the board. Now, the last one which I can say is, you have said methodology, but I believe that you have focused more on hypothesis than on the methodology. What kind of resources we have offered to primary resources, secondary resources that you might have taken. And in fact, Ashoka's idea of Dhamma also is based on the idea of ITS behavior and social responsibility. So can you say that even Pule, when he was emphasizing on ITS behavior, was he drawing something from also from Indian history?
Yeah. Thank you, sir, for your compliments also and queries. The uniqueness in the Fule's movement was his approach, which was radical in social as well as religious terms. His other contemporaries were not radical at all. They were in the framework of actually Brahminical discourses. There may be differences in between them, but they all fall in the Brahminical discourse. Yes, of course. Ramabai also fall in this discourse. And I will come to your very later on. About Indian theory, though I have actually seen Fule, actually located Fule's framework in the Gramscian as well as Foucaultian perspective. And this is my theory, this is my right to propose a theory or to, you know, locate his moment. But about the Indian theories or the Indian perspective, I have mentioned in my presentation also, actually Fule saw his moment as a sequel of, you know, Shramanic tradition and Bhakti tradition. Bhakti means particularly radical Bhakti tradition. In Bhakti movements also, there are two traditions, that is Brahminical Bhakti tradition, and the other one is radical Bhakti that was actually propounded by the lower caste reformers or saints. So Fule saw his moment in this line. Actually, he referred mostly Kabir and Tukaram and Buddha also. And about your third query, I'm not competent enough to, you know, comment on this very big or actually vague generalization how to compare Phule with Buddha or Gandhi or so many other reformers which you have mentioned. I cannot answer this question. And finally, what was your last
methodology?
Actually, in view of the shortage of time, I have skipped some of the parts of my presentation. I have mentioned in my in a written presentation the my sources as well as methodological framework also, and I have used mostly all of the primary sources, that is writings of Phule. I have not left any of the writing of Phule, his plays, his books, his polemical works, his plays, his poetry. So I have referred most of the primary sources.
But public source?
Iska? I have pointed out this, that I have propounded a new theory that was not suggested by anyone. Particularly, I have seen basically historiography on Phule, and most of the writings are written in Marathi. But as far as Marathi writers are concerned, most of their, for instance, I have seen the work of Hari Narke and some Dr. Aglave and some other writers.
English
translation? No, not English translation. They are English as well as Hindi translations also. And English translations are not very much available of the Marathi sources or Marathi writings. So I have met all of them, many of them. And their work, so far as I understand, their work are just hagiographical works. And they have also, collected so many numerous facts about these movements in their writings. But they have not proposed a theory or a new, framework of understanding or a hypothesis. So in terms of, modern theoretical frameworks. And in the historical writings written in English, there is only one serious work that was authored by Rosalind O'Hanlon. O'Hanlon's work is really a remarkable work, and it is a great contribution. But apart from this work, some other writers have also done. For instance, Gail Lumbeth has dealt Phule's moment in one of the chapters of her work, Cultural Revolt in a Colonial Society, and some other works also, for instance, M.S. Gore. But they are not full-fledged research. They have not done full-fledged researches on Phule. So only one research has been done, and after that work, I think my work would be the second, which would be full-fledged research on Phule. I have written about 300 pages on Phule and his moment. Thank you.
Yes, 1 minute.
Thank you for very stimulating speech, very nice technical work on pulling, which very nice kind of piece. I have to make certain observations. I am not from this field, I have to do this based on my experiences, you said that
Martin Luther.
And recently there is one book, I guess, by Ismail Gilbertson. Past, Northern Author, Historians.
Will you repeat?
Past, Northern Author, Historians.
Okay.
This is by the Black Lady. You can find it all in the book. I think this month and then we will. And she has compared past in India with the
And she says that past is another she says this past is worse than this. Past is like here, so it's not visible, right? Sometimes it becomes blue. That everyone knows the all about this. It will suffer them, right? So it's like past is like everything is okay. Your body is okay, it's like walls, it's better. And the glass is there. And this is the structure. So many things are there.
It's not referring to King, he was referring to Luther.
It's
also relevant.
Okay.
At the time when Professor Pankhle was talking about something, something new should be brought on, right? I think the difference between Pankhle and Chahal is like that. One of the Indian Prime Minister, the second party, that I understand, not order, but it's the so-called upper class people, they have sympathy. Like you said, other people, other informal, they have sympathy, whereas there is empathy. Empathy. The people have no creativity as well. Sympathize with only then you can understand there. So there is a difference. When someone from upper class background wants to sympathize, then for it. They don't feel the pain when they talk about the issues. It's my experience. And even that Prime Minister once said, right in the parliament, second time I think that they were on the vote of Congress, and then he said, our party, the name of the party, we are not untouchable. We are not
untouchable.
So like the earlier I said, no. So I was listening there, I said, why is he not untouchable? He is a key body in society. What does it connote? Because
yes.
So he was writing the whole Indian class system. We are not untouchable. So what does it mean? I think this researching. And as you said, Kulia is an American and Musa were later for the leaders. Is there any room? Is the question to be asked in front of the centuries? Is the world reform? Is it the more stubborn? Why don't we go there? Because of the question to be answered. Who might be? I think that
was
my
understanding. Okay, thank you. One thing, the question is, you said Mahavali has utopia. Utopia is actually a dream project, actually an idea of an idol society. Idol society. So, Dr. Amarjit, Professor Amarjit, at the outset, I would like to thank you for coming here. It's from Madhya Pradesh University, and a friend of mine has come for me to listen, to hear me. And he has been chairing Ambedkar chair also here. So, and about as regards your observations, I totally agree with you. And about the problem of apartheid or black, you have mentioned. In the introductory chapter of my monograph, I have done a lot of effort to understand this problem and also compare with other problems of or other similar problems of the world, and apartheid or the black problem is also like one, but there are also some uniqueness in this problem of untouchability or the problem of caste. I think there is a difference between Martin Luther King and Martin Luther that has been pointed out. Martin Luther was a reformist Protestant leader in Christianity. He came in the era of Reformation, Renaissance, as well as Reformation in 15th, 16th century. And he did a lot of radical reform in Christianity. And after that, many other reformers also came. And a new, you know, sect emerged in Christianity that was Protestant sect. Okay. Thank you. And I have compared Fule with Martin Luther. Just wait,
Professor Raju, just a minute. He's finishing his argument.
Just wait.
Can I say something on this, Subbu?
Can you just wait for a minute? He is responding to a query, and after that, we'll take you.
So, I have forgotten. Martin. So, I think I have answered your queries.
Okay, we can take first Professor Raju, and then we'll take Professor NPC's question.
This analogy,
Professor Batley,
with Martin Luther is, to my mind, completely off. What kind of reform did Martin Luther do? Did he change the Nicene Council? Do Protestants reject the Nicene Council? Do they reject Augustine? I believe you don't know anything of Christian theology. You're just going by some vague story that he carried out some reform, that he changed. All that Protestants do is not to accept the Pope. And did he change the Bible? How much of fraud was done in the Bible? Newton wrote a whole 7-volume history of the church. Have you read it? What reform did he do? Did he change what Aquinas said? Post-Crusade theology? Did he change Christian rational theology? He did nothing of the sort. Only one issue of the Pope. Just one person. All right? That means no reform. That is no serious reform. There is just a big story about it because the church was so very oppressive, it did not tolerate any dissent. This very minor dissent, all right, this very minor dissent has become a big story and you are trying to correlate it. It's a wild correlation, absolutely wild correlation. I do not at all agree with it. There is nothing to link except that Jyotiba Phule may have been a victim of the missionaries. I don't see that there is any analogy between him and Martin Luther. Please read your Christian history before you make this kind of a wild will.
Thank you, okay. Dr. Raju. I think that's an important point,
Doctor,
that we cannot just, you know, randomly compare someone like Luther with Jyotiba Phule, because they're totally different kind of interventions in religion happening. We'll ask Professor.
May I respond?
Yeah.
Sir, I actually I have not compared Phule with Martin Luther. Actually, I have given a term, given a title. Phule was actually the Luther of Hinduism.
That's what
he said. So this is not comparison. This is not comparison. And as regards Luther's contribution, though, just listen to me, Professor Raju. Actually, we have.
His contribution was as different as that of Luther.
Actually, we have learned a lot of history from a mathematician, and thank you for your you are always giving insights on history. But I do not agree. I do not.
Martin Luther. You have a right to disagree.
No, no, no.
Let him finish.
No. What is post-Nicene theology?
Please let me complete. No.
Changes were made in the Bible. Have you studied them? Have you studied what?
Professor Raju, please let me complete. Let me complete first.
Any of that?
Let me.
Just making a wild remark.
Let me complete.
Okay.
And you don't want to learn. Because when I point out all this, what are the manipulations that are done in the Bible? Why don't you read my book itself? Don't read what Newton wrote. Don't read what his. Just read this stuff. Just read some basic stuff.
Martin
Luther, you know, opposed basically Pepsi, but actually the Reformation movement, which was actually a big big movement in Christianity, later on converted into a very big, you know, move or a moment in Christianity. And so many things have been written, so many histories have been written on Reformation movement. And I think we should not go into that debate. Let us focus on Jyotirao Phule. I just so used...
We'll go on to okay. the other question. We'll go to the other question. So, Professor Singh.
I compliment Professor for a very interesting and intriguing presentation. I have a few comments and maybe questions. One thing that intrigues me is that in more recent century, Satya seems to be more favored than Dharma. In history, in Indian history, earlier on, Dharma was more significantly recurrent theme. And in more recent times, Satya seems to be sort of competing with Dharma, because emphasis on Satya is there in Phule. In a great way. Emphasis on Satya is there in a great way, even in Gandhi. So, Satya seems to have also Satya.
Dayanand also.
So that's one theme. Another point that I want to make seems to be that I was asking the question, why is there no Phule in Hindi-speaking states?
Indian?
Hindi-speaking states.
Okay.
Why is Phule only in Maharashtra? And a kind of critique of, Brahminism, not so much of Hinduism, in Maharashtra. Critics of Hinduism have been, more radical critics of Hinduism have or Brahminism have been there in the south. But there is no such radical criticism of Hinduism in Hindi-speaking states. That's a question that comes to my mind. Why? It seems to me that without the rise of the Maratha state, there may not have been a Phule in Maharashtra. Maratha state was a major historical event. Shivaji rose from the middle strata of Hindu society. So much so that when he conquered territory, particularly in the beginning in Maharashtra, the Brahmanas of Maharashtra refused to coronate him as the king. They said that you are not a Brahmin, you are not a Kshatriya.
Yes.
So we cannot coronate him.
Correct.
Then Brahmins from Banaras were called
Gagabat
to coronate him.
Mm-hmm.
So it seems to me, and so you know, from a middle strata of society, Chhatrapati Maharaj Shivaji rose to be the king, and then he was not so critical of Hinduism, and if he had been critical of Hinduism and Brahminism. Peshwas, who were Brahmins from Pune, would not have become virtual power wielders in post-Shivaji Maratha state. In post-Shivaji Maratha state, the Peshwas of the Brahmins of Pune became hereditary prime ministers of the Maratha post-Shivaji Maratha state, and the Maratha king in Satara became just a virtual nominal king. A real power was wielded by the Peshwa, the hereditary prime minister. So that's another point that came to my mind. Why Phule only in Maharashtra?
Yeah.
not in other non-trivial schemes. Another point that comes to my mind, that those who talk about Dalit Bahujan discourse, they tend to conflate nuances, because Phule used the word Bahujan, and Dalit, I don't know who first started using the word Dalit, I don't know whether Ambedkar or someone else.
No, it was also used by Phule.
So that's a addition to my knowledge.
Yeah, for the first time.
But, you know, Bahujan Samaj, Bahujan word come is more frequent in Phule. Mm-hmm. And in fact, that was adopted by the Bahujan Samaj Party, the scheduled caste party in UP. And from there, another intriguing point that comes to my mind is that why is there a scheduled caste party only in UP? Why not elsewhere? In no other state, in North India. There are three states in India where scheduled castes are larger in numbers than in UP. Himachal Pradesh, Punjab, and West Bengal. In none of these states where scheduled castes are larger than in the UP, you find a scheduled caste, a specifically scheduled caste party.
Yeah.
So you know, these are a few ideas that came to my mind. I wanted to share with you. Thank you,
sir. Thank you. Actually, about your observations, I am thankful to you. And I also do hold the same, almost the similar positions, particularly about the rise of Maratha state. I would also point out another thing. There was also a specific bhakti movement in Maharashtra. And in this moment, the saints belonging to the lower strata came from the very outset, from you know, Namdev up to Tukaram. And Phule was in
the bhakti movement in the north.
No.
From the south.
Yeah.
Bhakti movement in North India
came from the south.
Via Maharashtra.
Yeah. And in this particular Maharashtrian bhakti movement, we have this idea of social radicalism, particularly in Namdev, and it was actually the foundation provided by bhakti movement, on which Maratha state emerged. We should also keep this point in mind. And after that, Phule or this known Brahmin movements emerged on this whole background. And about this, about your remarks about or comments on the concept of Satya, I also agree with you. In modern times, this concept has become more important because this is a time of modernity. This is a time of rationality. So here, this term, and all of these reformers, for this, you know, that these three stalwarts used this term in their different ways. You mentioned Gandhi, you mentioned Dayananda also, who wrote Satyarth Prakash. Gandhi repeatedly used Satya and Ahimsa, and Phule also founded Satya Shodhak Samaj. But though they have their different meanings of truth, but all of them actually had direct or indirect influence from the West. Actually, this idea of modernity came from the West, and this made a very big challenge to the reform, to the Indians or the reformers. Yeah.
You know, Dayananda Saraswati used
Vikram Satyarth Prakash. Yeah.
But Dayananda was a Hindu revivalist. Gandhi also used the term Satya, but he cannot be said to be a Hindu revivalist, a Hindu reformist. And of course, Phule appears to me, from your account, to be more radical than Gandhi.
No doubt.
Gandhi was more sort of comprehensively inclusive, whereas the Bahujan, Dalit Bahujan discourse of Phule appears to be. Sort of it doesn't go beyond Hindu freedom, but it is more tilted towards the lower orders of Hindu society.
Now, the another point is that
to Phule. One little comment here. If you look at certain other traditions which emerged, which are anti-radical, anti-caste, anti-Brahmanical, you can also call it anti-Hindu. One major example is the Satnam movement, Satnami Sampradaya in Chhattisgarh. They used Satnam, the true name. And it's, I mean, they actually draw their lineage from an earlier Bhakti movement tradition from Haryana. They claim descent from that.
Yeah.
But they use the term Satnam, and it's a radically anti-caste, anti-Brahmanical, monotheistic religion, religious tradition. And by and large, except for some hearsay about Christ and things, they were not influenced by any modern rationalist thinking.
Okay. Thank you, sir, for your observations. We will also discuss later on this.
Dataram.
Just one line.
Switch on.
I would rather request you to consider that this Satya is not against Dharma. Satya is Dharma. And there is no real difference between these two. You remember, Sadguru is a term which signifies the not only truth, but also some kind of association with Dharma. So, I do appreciate that you brought in this issue of going towards the place, at least in the popular world. Because politics require this kind of shift of the content wise, the names you have referred, all those stood for that. Okay. I would like to
Alka wants to say something on this issue before we go to Agar. Can you come to the speaker?
I'd just like to respond to Hitenji's Professor Patel's statement that Satya is Dharma. I would like to say that Dharma is extremely contested as well as Satya.
Yeah.
So Dharma is not Satya.
Oh. No, the difference is, if I put it in totally modern terms, Dharma relates to policy, what I ought to do. And Satya is what is real. So there is a crossing of the two. But somewhere, the distinction, both epistemologically and in practical politics, is always maintained from, as he pointed out, from Ashokan times.
I would also, point out Phule's ideas of Satya here. Actually, Phule used to say, or actually he had used this term in his moment, in his pamphlet, in his books also, repeatedly, Satya meva jayate. And this is an ancient saying. Satya meva jayate, and it looks Upanishad. Actually, Phule, as I have pointed out, Phule was influenced by this Shramanic tradition. And in this Shramanic tradition, Ashok Buddha, and later on Ashoka was also influenced by him. And Phule's ideas of truth was actually different from all of the ideas of truth propounded by modern reformers. In this, in the way that other reformers, took meanings of the truth from the Shastras, whereas Phule used this term only in a highly rational way, because to him, the conscience, one's conscience is the thing where which is given evidence by his one's conscience is the truth. He actually used to say another saying of Marathi, Satya Asatya Mekele Gavahi. Satya or Asatya Me असत्य और असत्य में फर्क जो है वो आपकी अंतरात्मा बताएगी. सो इट वॉज ए हाईली रैशनल पर्सन एंड ही आर इवन रिफ्यूटेड शास्त्रा आल्सो. वेयर इज गांधी और अदर थिंकर्स डिडंट रिफ्यूट शास्त्रा बट ही हैज
By experiments with truth. He discovered truth through his experiments. Okay. And that is shown in Champaran, that is shown in the National
But he called himself a Sanatanist Hindu also. He didn't disbelieve in Shastra.
So
with apologies to Dataramji, I think Balramji wants to intervene on this point.
I don't find it categorically declared that how he was different from Brahmin. His social recognition of his bhakti movement was different from his Brahmanistic parameters. My confusion, maybe another confusion is, you say that bhakti philosophy is influenced not by theological texts, philosophical texts, but by the teachings of saints like Kabir, Mahavir, Buddha. How can we differentiate these saints from the major philosophical tradition of Islam? This is not any sect, this is not any religion, or it is not dharma. It is a philosophical tradition. Look at the terms or at the philosophical constructs that he uses. Jini, the meaning to the root. Ingla, Pimla, Tana, Mama. Susumna, Tarase, meaning. Or when he sings a song, Mere Dulhani Gao, Mangal Char, Mere Hirai, Hata, Or Ulu Jayaga, Hansa, Akela. I think whether it is Namdev or whether it is any sect, the Indian Bhakti tradition, you cannot say that he deviates or he departs from this set or this configuration of philosophy. That is my question.
Actually, you have to go into the minute, you know, nuances in Brahmani. So I will come to your question later. Pranjpe has raised his finger.
So thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm very fascinated by this discussion on rationality, because I think that the entire project of modernity is somehow, should I say, predicated on what we mean by reason. You know? Now the question arises, is the Western notion of reason different from the Indian, especially in the 19th century? And then also, in other words, the point I'm trying to make is, rather than being bogged down in terminology such as revival, reform, and so on, because these are terms which have no clear meaning, frankly, you know. I think if you shift the debate to reason or rationality and notions of rationality, I think something new will come. And I feel that even in the Indian tradition, there are many words. Balramji may also wish to add something to this discussion. Many words for reason and rationality, you know. For example, anvikshiki, tark, you know, and there are many, many words. And each of these has a different meaning. I think Professor Singh spoke about Gandhi using reason. And there's a very famous debate between Gandhi and Tagore on the Bihar earthquake. In fact, I wrote a paper on it. And you have two very different ideas of reason there. And people like Amartya Sen and, you know, even Sugata Bose claimed that Gandhi was on the side of irrationality, unreason, using conscience and, you know, other ideas. And I tried to counter that. And my paper was actually published in the Oxford Journal of Hindu Studies, where I made the point that it's not rationality versus superstition, or faith versus superstition, or rationality versus irrationality. There are contending notions of rationality. This is my point. And for example, think about the word pragya. Now, pragya is not necessarily irrational. You know, it is tarkasangat. It does the positive sensory data, and the intuitive understanding of reality are not seen clashing with one another. So my whole point is that if we can focus on these contending notions of reason, because let's not forget that Dayanand was also arguing on the basis of reason, and he was refuting, you know, all traditions, almost all traditions except the Vedas. And when we heard Radha Vallabhji speak, he told us how he was not against Murti Pujan to begin with, or rather against the Puranas to begin with. And later he said, no, they're irrational. So what I'm really trying to say is that, you know, these great reformers or thinkers, or should I say thought leaders of the 19th century, were coming up, were inventing, I would say, a special hermeneutics, each one of them, Ambedkar included. And this hermeneutics was partly based on the West. I agree with what Chahal Sahib is saying. It was partly based on Enlightenment thinking, ideas of liberty, equality, fraternity. You see, we talk about Dr. Ambedkar, we don't talk about fraternity. See, fraternity was very important for him. Even in your presentation, Professor Chahal, you're focused on equality. See, one of the problems with the caste system in India, it was not just about equality, it was also about fraternity. It was a prohibition of fraternity.
Yes.
And no modern state can exist without fraternity. Anyhow, so my point is that if you can unpack these subtle nuances and differences in the hermeneutics, you know, and I feel that we should not take strategic opposition for real opposition, because when I read Dr. Ambedkar, though he converts out of Hinduism, you know, if you read Annihilation of Caste very carefully, he says, I want to help my Hindu friends. He says that they are deluded, and whenever they want my help, I will help them. So you see, we have to see strategic opposition, we have to see real opposition, then we have to see incommensurables, that certain things are incommensurable. For example, if you say Hinduism equals inequality, then no reform is possible, you know, and only conversion out of Hinduism is possible, for example. And if you say that Christ equals morality and Hinduism equals immorality, again, you're setting up all kinds of problems. So if you look at three or four such hermeneutical inventions, I would say, Ram Mohan Roy, he had a huge debate with the missionaries. It was all published, the Baptist missionaries and he. And he said, you're saying we are not rational, you're also not rational. How can one God be three? Three into one, you know? So these debates, what I'm simply saying is these debates are worth contextualizing. Phule doesn't come out of nothing, out of a vacuum. Phule comes out of a series of debates before him, and he impacts and impinges on a series of debates after him. And in all these debates, somehow central to these debates is the notion of rationality. And since you brought in Foucault, Foucault is one of the greatest critics of rationality. You see, Foucault is actually saying that reason is irrational. He is a great critic of the Enlightenment project. So please, let us think through these things very carefully. And I believe that today's discussion, at least for me, has been very productive. Because if you can contrast Dayanand's notion of rationality with Phule's, with Ram Mohan Roy's, with some neo-Vedantists who don't reject reason. You mentioned Chahal Sahib very interestingly that his Mahaparinirvan Din is coming on the 6th. I would like 6th of December. I'd like to remind you that you know, if you want to use the same terminology for Sri Aurobindo, that's 5th of December. Now, if you look at Sri Aurobindo and his notion of supramentalization, it's not a rejection of reason, once again. And so please, all I'm saying is if you contextualize these debates, if you place them in a framework, your project will become very rich and you will see Gandhi's rationality is different from Ambedkar's. Because, see, Ambedkar gives this amazing speech in Pune where he says, you know, we were brought up by Gokhale and Ranade and we wanted to be modern. And look at Gandhi. He's mystical. He's an irrational man. And he will take us backwards. He will take us into thinking, you know, with myths and fantasies. So once again, Ambedkar's critique of Gandhi is based on reason. So I just want to submit, Professor Chahal, for your consideration that you have hit upon something very important. And if you concentrate a little bit on these differing and competing notions of what is reason, what is reasonable, you know, and how they play out in the political, social, cultural, and religious sphere, I think we'll have something very important. And one little thing, I was very moved by what Subbuji said in the beginning. I know Eklavya has done amazing work, especially to create materials to make school education interesting. I wanted to add a footnote to what he said. See, what we are seeing, Subbuji, is a Dalitization of the Brahmins. You look at Rajasthan, and they are some of the most backward and poor communities, and they are deprived of all benefits. There's no benefit from the state. The Brahmins have got Dalitized. The Dalits have got Brahminized. Now, I'm using these terms in a sociological sense, just as you use them. This is a sociology of knowledge that we are talking about. And what's happening to our government schools? The government schools are losing all students. So they are actually becoming means of paying the salary of teachers. There are empty schools because, you know, so these are very complex issues. And Phule's educational philosophy, which you mentioned, which is not in this project, also bears thinking. So I hope that Professor Chahal also takes some points from you, because as I hinted, today when we look at re-evaluating Phule, you know, his school, his education philosophy is more radical than his social philosophy, you know. Yeah. See, this is a new way of looking at Phule, because everybody has talked about his social philosophy, his anti-Brahmanism. That has been done and redone, and Ambedkar took it to a level. You see, that has already been deeply entrenched. And as you said, Pauli O'Hanlon and others have written about it. But what about his educational philosophy? What about the new materials that they created? You see, I think these bear a deeper research. Thank you so much. Thank you for your time. Thank you.
Thank you. And thank you have two questions to answer. One set of
let me first comment on what Professor Paranthe has pointed out. Professor Paranthe, I am thankful to you for your valuable insights at the outset. And I do agree with you that the idea of fraternity is more important than the idea of equality. And I think you have read Ambedkar thoroughly, and you have gone into the debate into his essay on this liberty, equality, and fraternity, where he has categorically pointed out that without equality, no liberty can be formed, and without fraternity, no equality and liberty can be achieved. So Ambedkar gave equal importance to all of these three ideas, and he has drawn his idea of liberty, equality, and fraternity not from the West. He has claimed that he has drawn his idea from Buddha. And about Phule, you know, I would like to draw your attention on the ideas of Satyashodhak Samaj. Here he has categorically pointed out that we want to achieve equality, fraternity, and rationality in Hindu society. So So Phule was also for fraternity. So he has equally given importance to these conceptions. And lastly, I think that is the important point which I want to submit. Thank you, Professor Pranthe, for your insights.
There are two more questions. One from, I think, Tini has a question, and Prasenjit has a question.
I understood his question. Actually, sir, my project and actually the project of Phule was not against Hinduism at all. This is my position. So let me. I understood your. Let me explain now. You have to go into the nuances. In Hinduism also, there are so many streams, and Phule, who was influenced by the Shramanic as well as Shramanic tradition, was also part of Hinduism, and he was also influenced by radical Bhakti. This term is used by me. Actually, in Hinduism also, there is Dvaitvad, there is Advaitvad. There are so many philosophies, and in Brahmanism, there is idea of hierarchy. There is idea of the so-called sacred books. There is the idea of the privileges of so-called Brahmins or the high caste. Phule was against these things. Okay, so here is the difference between. Obviously, this was in the Indian philosophy and Phule.
There can be difference.
And Phule was not against Hinduism.
So Balramji kuch.
Phule was not against Hinduism. He was against Brahmanism.
सर बहुत बधाई है आपको, बहुत अच्छा प्रेजेंटेशन था आपका. सुधारवादी कहते हुए आपने फूले को एक आस्तिक सुधारवादी के रूप में प्रस्तुत किया, और जितने भी सुधारवादी होते हैं उनके प्रति संपूर्ण सम्मान व्यक्त करते हुए एक बात कहनी होती है कि उनके पास एक मेथडोलॉजी होती है, एक चालाकी तो नहीं कह सकते, वो दो तरह के पास्ट को क्रिएट करते हैं, एक रिसेंट पास्ट, एक रिमोट पास्ट, एक निकट अतीत और एक सुदूर अतीत. तो निकट अतीत का वो विरोध करते हैं, उनके अनुसार ये सुदूर अतीत में बहुत अच्छा था सब कुछ, चाहे आप किसी को भी देखें, दयानंद को देखें, राम मोहन राय को देखें, वो कहते हैं कि वैदिक काल में सब कुछ अच्छा था और बाद में भी इसमें सब गड़बड़ हुआ. तो मैं ये पूछना चाह रहा था कि जानना चाह रहा था आपसे कि फूले का जो रिमोट पास्ट है, जिसको वो जिसके आधार पर एक्चुअली रिमोट पास्ट कोई भी रिफॉर्मिस्ट इसलिए क्रिएट करता है कि लोक में उसकी लोक से समर्थन प्राप्त कर सके, लोक से बिल्कुल अलग नहीं कर सकता ना, एलिनेट हो जाएगा. तो जैसे जैसे बड़े बड़े धर्म आए, जैसे इस्लाम भी कहता है कि इस्लाम पहले से था और बीच में सब कुछ बदल गया, सब कुछ सब लोग, तो इनको समझने के लिए हमें ये समझना इंपॉर्टेंट होगा कि इनका रिमोट पास्ट क्या था. जैसे आपने बार बार कहा श्रमण और भक्ति ट्रेडिशन, लेकिन साथ साथ आपने ये भी कहा कि इन्होंने हिंदुइज्म का विरोध नहीं किया. तो हिंदुइज्म के जो आधारभूत ग्रंथ हैं, आप तथा कथित कुरीतियों को हटा दीजिए, तो क्या भूले उनको रिफर करते हैं क्या, ये बहुत इंपॉर्टेंट प्रश्न है इस दृष्टि से. चलो अब इस तरफ.
जी जी ठीक. जी जी जी.
तो एक चीज ये, और एक चीज जो अभी चर्चा हुई उसके विषय में मैं कहता हूं कि आधुनिक लोगों ने सत्य का किस तरह से प्रयोग किया, इसके विषय में तो बहुत ज्यादा नहीं जानता मैं, लेकिन सत्य हमेशा धर्म के पर्याय के रूप में परंपरा में आया है. जैसा फतेहसर ने कहा, इसके लिए आप सैकड़ों उक्तियां दे सकते हैं, सत्यान नास्ति परो धर्म, सत्यनारायण और सत्यात्मकम सत्य परम तो सत्य, ईश्वर सत्यात्मक है, सत्य से बड़ा कोई धर्म नहीं है. बाद में सत्य को किस रूप में देखा गया, ये तो ये केवल एक जोड़ने के रूप में था. मुख्य प्रश्न मेरा ये था
उसको समझा जा
सके। थैंक यू डॉक्टर बलराम। आपने एक तो रिमोट पास्ट की बात करी, एक चीज मैं मेरे प्रेजेंटेशन में आपने शायद नोट करी होगी, फूले का जो रिमोट पास्ट था नो डाउट एक यूटोपिया क्रिएट करना था ना फूले को भी, तो वो उसके लिए एक जो है आपका पॉइंट ठीक है कि कहीं पास्ट से तो लाना पड़ेगा क्योंकि सोसाइटी में उस चीज़ों की वैलिडिटी होती है। फूले का जो रिमोट पास्ट है वो है बलिराज, ये उसका जो मैंने एक शब्द यूज किया था उसका यूटोपिया है। सो फूले अपना एक यूटोपिया लेके आते हैं भारत में,
वही राजा जो
सुनो 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 तो
बलिराज के बारे में
सुनो, एक
प्रश्न है जिसके बारे में आपसे पूछता हूँ बलराम जी से। बलि राजा वैदिक कथा में है कि पौराणिक कथा?
सर सर
पौराणिक 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 कथा जो है वो रिमोट पास्ट हिंदुइज्म का पौराणिक पास्ट, रिमोट पास्ट वैदिक तो ट्राइबल सोसाइटी, वहाँ ज्यादा इक्वालिटी, वहाँ ऊंच नीच का फर्क बहुत कम था। ट्राइबल सोसाइटी का वैदिक हिस्टोरियंस को बताते हैं कि वैदिक सोसाइटी वाज बेसिकली ट्राइबल सोसाइटी, वॉर्स इन द ऋग्वेदा दैट ट्राइबल वॉर्स, सो इक्वालिटी वहाँ ज्यादा था। पौराणिक पौराणिक पीरियड में आकर के इनइक्वालिटी ज्यादा आ जाती है।
एक्चुअली
बलि राजा का जो उन्होंने मिथक लिया है वो कुरान से लिया है, लेकिन उसको शायद उन्होंने रिफाइन किया होगा।
नहीं, मैं बताता हूँ, असल में फूले ना तो पुराण से लेते और ना वैदिक काल से। फूले का आइडिया असल में आता है लिटिल ट्रेडिशन से, जो निचली जातियाँ जो फोक ट्रेडिशन है महाराष्ट्र में खासकर, उनमें बलि का एक बड़ा जबरदस्त कंसेप्ट है बलिराज का। वैसे देखो तो केरला में भी है ये जो बलि का कंसेप्ट, निचले वर्गों में अगर आप देखें ना तो ये जो बलि का जो फिनोमिना है असल में जो आर्यन रेस की जो थ्योरी है ना उससे जोड़ते हैं फूले इसको। वो कहते हैं पहले आर्यों से भी पहले बलि का राज होता था इस देश के जो मूल निवासी थे। असल में फूले ने एक मूल निवासी शब्द बहुत यूज किया है, और ये मूल निवासी थ्योरी जो है फूले ने असल में रेशियल थ्योरी को बिल्कुल ही सर के बल कर दिया। फूले ने जैसे दूसरे जिसमें ब्राह्मणिस्ट भी इसमें यकीन करते थे उस जमाने के, वो ये कहते थे हम अंग्रेजों के यूरोपियन लोगों के बराबर है इसलिए हम ऊंचे हैं, इसलिए हमारा क्लेम जो है शूद्रों वगैरह से ऊपर है। तो फूले ने कहा कि ठीक है अगर आप लोग आर्य हैं आप बाहर से आए तो हमारा इस देश में के मूल निवासी हम थे, और हमारे जो एक आइडल जो रोल मॉडल राजा थे वो थे बलि। तो जो राजा बलि का निचले वर्गों में जो कंसेप्ट है ना वो जो डिस्कोर्स है वो हाँ पॉलिटिकल ट्रेडिशन
हटा दिया गया,
वो बिल्कुल अलग है। और फूले ने इसकी बिल्कुल एक नई इंटरप्रिटेशन करी है, और महाराष्ट्र में खासकर बड़ा पॉपुलर भी है किसानों में। महाराष्ट्र के किसानों में एक ऐसी कहावतें हैं कि भाई जैसे वो कई पवित्र अनुष्ठान जब करते थे घरों में किसान लोग और दलित लोग भी, तो वे कह वो एक मुझे एग्जैक्ट मराठी सही याद नहीं, तो ये कहते थे कि बलि राज आए और ये सारी जो बीमारियां हैं जो धर्म के नाम पे ब्राह्मणों ने ला दी हैं ये सारी खत्म हो। तो फूले वहां से ड्रा कर रहे हैं अपनी जो आइडियोलॉजी उसके ऊपर बेस कर रहे हैं, क्योंकि फूले का इलेक्टोरेट भी वही है। और दूसरा ग्रंथों की जो आपने बात कही, फूले असल में देखिए बुक के बिल्कुल खिलाफ है। देखिए ये जो आइडिया है ना बुक के भी धर्म की कोई ना कोई बुक होनी चाहिए, ये असल में मॉडर्न आइडिया है, मॉडर्निटी से ही आता है, खासकर क्रिश्चियनिटी के साथ और इस्लाम के साथ भी, क्योंकि इन दोनों धर्मों में किताब है। लेकिन फूले से असल में फूले जिस परंपरा में आते हैं, जैसे मैंने बताया श्रामणिक परंपरा है, जो श्रामणिक परंपरा है बुद्ध जो है वो किताब को नहीं मानते, वो वेद को नहीं मानते। भारत में ये जो परंपरा रही है जो वेद शास्त्र उसको खारिज करने वाली रही, और फूले इसलिए किसी भी किताब में यकीन नहीं करते। वो ये कहते हैं सबसे बड़ी जो किताब है वो तो आपका कॉन्शियंस है, जैसे बुद्ध का एक विचार है अत्व दीपो भव, अपने दीप खुद बनो, आपको किसी किताब की तरफ देखने की जरूरत नहीं। यही कबीर कहते हैं पोथी पढ़ पढ़ जग मुआ पंडित भयानक होए, और यही बात कबीर कह रहे हैं फूले कह रहे हैं कि हमें इन ब्राह्मणों की पोथियों में कोई भरोसा नहीं है। इनमें फूले और अम्बेडकर के शब्दों में खास कर कहूँ तो वो कहते हैं अगर आपको हिंदू धर्म को रिफॉर्म करना है, परांजपे साहब भी ये ठीक कह रहे थे हिंदू धर्म के खिलाफ नहीं है दोनों ही व्यक्ति, वो ये कह रहे हैं अगर हिंदू धर्म को रिफॉर्म करना है तो इन ब्राह्मणवादी परंपराओं को इन शास्त्रों को जो कि इन ब्राह्मणिकल वैल्यूज को सपोर्ट करते हैं इनको हमें खारिज करना होगा। और
पुस्तकों को आगे करके आप कंट्रास्ट नहीं क्रिएट कर सकते, इसी तरह की सारी बातें तथा कथित ब्राह्मणिक परंपरा में है, ज्ञान ज्ञान पर्यंतम सारे शास्त्र तो वो
इंस्ट्रूमेंटल और जितना भी बौद्ध परंपरा या कुछ भी है तो सारी पुस्तकों की या किताबों की महत्ता तो मानते ही है। आप जानते हैं तक या जन्मों का द्वादशांग है, सारी चीजें हैं। तो हम इस तरह से कंट्रास्ट नहीं क्रिएट कर सकते कि किताबों को लेकर के हम कहें कि ये अलग परंपरा हो गई, अलग परंपरा। वो ज्यादा जरूरी है कि जो इक्वालिटी पर बेस्ड है वो ज्यादा इम्पोर्टेंट है। किताबों को खुद वो ज्ञान के पक्षधर है। आप क्या कहें कि ज्ञान के आधार पर
किताब को अंतिम सच न मानना, किताब को
डॉक्टर शुक्ला नाउ लेट मी
जब अंतिम सच मान लेते हैं तब प्रॉब्लम होती
है। नाउ लेट मी अच्छा मेरे भाई सुनो मेरे
अच्छा चलो
आप जो कह रहे हो कि उस ब्राह्मणिकल ट्रेडिशन में भी रैशनलिटी की बात है, लेकिन आप खुद बात तो सुनो। मैं चलो मान लेता हूँ थोड़ी सी देर के लिए, क्योंकि वहां भी ये डिस्कोर्स होगा, जरूर होगा। आप ज्यादा जानते हो, आप संस्कृत के आदमी हो, लेकिन आप एक हार्ड फैक्ट को क्यों भूल जाते हैं? आप खुद भी ये बात आपने एक्सेप्ट करी है मेरे साथ पर्सनल जब डिस्कशन हुए हमारे, एक फैक्ट को क्यों भूल जाते हैं? क्योंकि ब्राह्मणवादी परंपरा में जो जो बर्थ बेस्ड प्रिविलेज है उसको बहुत ज्यादा महत्व दे दिया गया है ना। अरे सुनो एक मिनट बात,
उसके विरोध में बात
पूरे बात तो सुनो एक बार, मुझे तो कहने दो। वो उन शास्त्रों में उन तथाकथित शास्त्रों में ही ये कहा गया है कि ये जो ब्राह्मण है ये जन्म के आधार पे ही हो, और दूसरा ये कि वो
शास्त्रों में कहा गया है जन्म कर्म से जो जाति प्रथा है वो
और उन्हीं शास्त्रों में ये भी कहा गया कि संस्कृत ऊपर से उतरी हुई भाषा है, बहुत पवित्र भाषा है। तो डॉक्टर साहब अरे क्यों नहीं कहा गया? आपने खुद कहा, आपने भाषण में ही कहा कि संस्कृत जो है वो पवित्र भाषा है, देवों की भाषा है। ये देवों की भाषा जब हो गई
और धुमागधी को भी देवों की भाषा कहा गया है, ये सब अर्थवाद है, केवल प्रशंसात्मक वाक्य है। स्वर्ग में थोड़ी बैठे, ये प्रशंसात्मक वाक्य है।
देखिए आप इस बात से इनकार नहीं कर सकते उन शास्त्रों में, शास्त्रों में
अर्धमागधी को भी देवों की भाषा।
नहीं नहीं उनका आप डिफेंड नहीं कर सकते, इसलिए फुल रैशनली की बात कर
रहे हैं। थोड़ा आगे आगे बढ़े आप।
My thing is personal, so I'll ask him a
question. Proceed.
Yes, sir. Yeah. So I'll just start with one comment. I'm a sociologist from B school. I can't, I take an exception. The term Brahmins are Dalitized. Brahmins can be impoverished, they can be discriminated against, but they can't be Dalitized until they are killed for drinking water from the same source that other people are. That's the problem, and that problem still persists. My second question is for, about today, is how much has his work sort of contributed to the anti-Brahmin sort of consolidation of identity in South India? The DNC movement.
Okay. I think first was your observation in response to Professor Paranjpe, and I have nothing to say about. I agree with you, and about
you agree with? Agree with
Prasanjit. And Prasanjit is a sociologist. We have to agree.
Now that's being safe.
Yeah. And about your another question. No doubt, Fule was a very unique person, a very unique reformer who has inspired so many traditions in modern times, anti-Brahmin or non-Brahmin traditions. You know, Fule was the first non-Brahmin movement. He launched this movement in about mid of the 19th century. You know, he founded his school in 1848 in the very, very tender, very young age of 20, and after that he worked a lot, and in 1873 in a very mature stage he founded this Satyashodhak Samaj. So Fule after his death inspired so many movements, and of course in the South Indian non-Brahmin traditions in Kerala also, in Mysore also, when I have gone to the, through the literature, I have found so many moments and so many such known Brahmin or Dalit moments who have got inspired from him in Mysore, in Kerala, in Telangana, in Chhattisgarh, in North India. Dalit moments also, depressed classes moments were also inspired by Phule. You know, when these depressed class associations were formed in the early 20th century, all of these associations were claiming that we are the original inhabitants of this land. So where this idea comes from? From Phule. And you know, the greatest recognition was given by Dr. Ambedkar himself. Ambedkar, though, did not fully agree to his, all of his theories or the racial theory or other ideas, but he has accepted that I call Phule as one of my three great gurus. And Phule, and he saw his moment as a sequel of the moment started by Jyotirao Phule.
Any other question, comment? We are 5:30 and I am sure the tea is going cold.
You also?
Can I conclude?
आपके बगैर तो कैसे होगा?
एक्चुअली
ऑन करो माइक.
I had enjoyed your presentation, mm-hmm. and you see yourself as social revolutionary, and you said many things which actually do not figure in the discussions. You said, if I have noted it correctly, that he made lower classes aware of their slavery. You said that.
Yeah.
Then you said that Brahmanism is a system of caste slavery, if I got it right.
Yeah.
And then you said anti-Brahmanism, he was not anti-Hinduism, he was anti-Brahmanism.
Yeah.
And then he talked about war with Brahmanism in Gulamagiri. I thought that these are the issues which actually should be dealt with any discussion on today. And the journey which began with Phule and continued up to Ambedkar, in spite of saying that they were all influenced by other kind of things, there is certain kind of force which is there in this movement. That is why this whole reading of those thinkers are not the not like any other thinkers. They are different. They are not merely thinkers. They have a transformatory impact.
Yeah.
And that is why they are so different. They were not thinkers merely. And that is why I would like to question the way these ideas of Ambedkar and Phule could be simply seen with other writers or thinkers. And I warn you, although I am not capable of advising that strongly, that this kind of digression from the core transformatory impact these thinkers carry should be thought of very in clear terms. Although I understand that there are certain kind of strategic opposition, not real opposition kind of things. And I do appreciate that point. That is very, very important. But these two thinkers are not really. And that part of your discussion, or that part of your work, is most vital. That vitality, how that can be, that can be part of your project, because This your project is not merely an academic project, merely academic project. That is how I look at it. It has to have certain kind of message, a very different kind. And there, I think, we will have to give due credit to Jyoti Basu. And nowadays, a kind of synthesis can be sort of thought of, where and this Bahujan discourse or Bahujan kind of thinking can use the insights of Phule, because he gives us a broader space to bring in on the table various groups, social groups. It is a larger group, because ultimately it boils down to the politics and political mobilization. And therefore, I think Dalitism would be benefited philosophically if Phule's ideas are incorporated in a constructive manner. Limitations must be there. He was a 19th century man working under a lot of pressures. So how these kind of things could be brought in, how these things can be brought in a project to give, to not get it diluted, is also a challenge with the project. This I want to
thank you. Thank you, Professor Patel, for your observation, and also appreciating the march on my presentation. Actually, I have also, you know, you have recognized that. I have said in my presentation that Phule was initially a social worker, and basically he became thinker when he worked on the field. So he was not initially a thinker, or he was not a, you know, drawing room thinker or drawing room intellectual like all of us. And he worked in the field, and his thinking was the outcome of his work on the ground. Another thing which I would like to, you know, share with all of you, that Phule was unique in another sense. He was the only man, I used to say that I have not found a single man in Indian society till now who is free from his caste bias. And this was only Phule who was totally free from his caste bias. You know, Phule never worked for his so-called Mali community. He worked for the Dalits. And Phule belonged to a very well-to-do family. He earned, his earnings from the contracts. And he had also a very big farm of 25 acres in Pune. Despite this position, economically he was well off, and socially he was better off from Dalits. He entirely worked for Dalits as well as women. And here is the uniqueness of Phule. When we see other refugees, Subbu sir also shared with me this, when we see other non-Brahmin leaders of the times who mainly focused on their caste, on their on the interest of their communities, on the interest of their caste, and ignored or missed the issues of depressed classes. But here with Phule alone, who paid attention to the most disadvantaged one. And about the concept of Bahujan, obviously this Bahujan concept was coined by Phule, and it has potentials. And this concept was popularized by most of the Dalit leaders. Kashiram founded the Bahujan Samaj Party. But I would also say that in Indian society, when we discussed with as social scientists, when we discussed Indian social problems, social issues, we normally borrow the Western concepts, the Western terminology. For instance, we talk in class terms. We never talk in caste terms. But in Indian society, the real phenomenon is caste. And here we have to find a new conception. It is the people of these lower caste actually fall in this broad category of Bahujan Samaj. So here is also a unique contribution of Phule to understand Indian society, as well as to initiate reform movement or even social movements or revolutionary movements against the unjust order, and I am thankful to you that you see me as a seeker, as a
see.
Thank you.
I'll thank you quickly because we have end of the day.
Yeah.
recently, I think the last issue of EPW, Gopal Guru had written a very interesting article on this issue of theory and empirical work in social sciences. And he says that there is this contrast that's being built up between theoretical Brahmins and empirical Shudras. And I think his work is very important because he is not going into the empirical details regarding Jyotiba Phule and his work, but focusing on certain theoretical and framework related issues. I think that's a very important shift. Normally, if you look at a historical work on Phule, you would find going into details, कि मैं वो क्या करते थे, उनके माँबाप क्या करते थे, उन्होंने ये किया, वो किया, ये लिखा, वो लिखा, 1902 में लिखा, 1864 में लिखा. But instead of that, focusing on certain larger theoretical issues relating to Phule and his contribution to caste emancipation or elimination of caste, I think that's a very important break in the kind of historiography we have, and I think we should be congratulated for that.
Thank you.
Having said that, I have a couple of points to make, which may be of interest to you, but it doesn't strictly come within the frame of a religious reform movement. But Phule's critique of colonialism is very important, because Phule basically was dealing with the colonial authorities and telling them that you're going the wrong way.
Yeah.
By relying on the Brahmanic upper castes and allying with them and building a modern Indian state based on their support. So that's a major break that Phule does in the nationalist discourse of trying to point out that there can be other kinds of nationalism, one, and that the British policy of predominantly relying on the upper caste, I think that has to be critiqued. I think both in education and in public policy, this was a very central to his theme. Other major issue that came up was the issue of knowledge. You referred to Foucault certainly. But what Foucault, like Professor Paranjpe also pointed this out, it's a critique of what is knowledge, what is valid knowledge needs to be problematized.
Yeah.
Phule actually was one of the pioneers in this because he problematized what knowledge is the valid knowledge. So the knowledge that was being, in my context, I can say that school education, what is the knowledge that should be taught to children was not something which he took for granted.
Yeah.
He problematized it and debated it, and that I think...
Constructed also.
Yeah. So I think that point was somewhat missing the presentation today, and I hope you would take it up.
I have discussed it. Yeah.
Thanks. Okay, that I'll stop there, but and thank for a very lively discussion on all related issues. We'll carry on, I suppose, the discussion outside.
Just wait, please. I also want to say something more because this is my final presentation. So I want to thank some of the persons who have been giving me so many supports. Actually, I completed my project, this project on Jyotirao Phule here. I also have completed another personal project. That is my autobiography. मैंने अपनी आत्मकथा भी लिखी यहाँ पे, ये काम भी किया. इट वॉज अ वेरी कंस्ट्रक्टिव पीरियड ऑफ माई लाइफ, ये मैं रिकॉर्ड पे ये चीज लाना चाह रहा हूँ। और इतना मैंने अपनी ऑटोबायोग्राफी में भी ये बात लिखी है कि IIAS में जिस तरह का माहौल है, मेरी ऑटोबायोग्राफी का टाइटल है जख्म अभी ताजा है, जैसे आपसे मैंने शेयर किया था, तो जिंदगी में जख्म काफी सारे मिले, लेकिन यहाँ पे मुझे, मैंने ये लिखा है कि यहाँ पे शायद मुझे लगता है कि मेरे जख्म भर जाएंगे
अगर
लेकिन तो उसका कारण ये है कि आप सब फेलोज से और यहाँ के डायरेक्टर से, यहाँ के दूसरे जो अथॉरिटीज हैं उनसे, यहाँ के बड़े और छोटे जो अधिकारी हैं उनसे, यहाँ के पूरे स्टाफ से जो मुझे सपोर्ट मिलता रहा आज, और इतना मान सम्मान जो मिलता रहा, सो आई एम ग्रेटफुल टू ऑल ऑफ यू एंड ऑल ऑफ द अथॉरिटीज, ऑल ऑफ द टीचर स्टाफ एंड ऑल ऑफ द माय फेलो कलीग्स। और मैं पर्टिकुलरली कुछ एक लोगों के नाम लेना चाहूँगा जिन लोगों का के प्रति मैं शुक्रगुजार हूँ। पर्टिकुलरली मैं सबसे पहले जो सिलेक्शन कमेटी थी जिसको चेयर कर रहे थे प्रोफेसर परांजपे, उसका शुक्रिया अदा करूँगा कि उन लोगों ने मेरे प्रोजेक्ट को इस लायक समझा और मुझे यहाँ पे इनवाइट किया। साथ ही मैं अपने तीनों चेयर्स को धन्यवाद दूंगा, मेरे तीन प्रेजेंटेशन हुए, एक्चुअली पांच प्रेजेंटेशन किए हैं वैसे तो मैंने, तो तीन तो मेरे इस ऑफिशियल प्रोजेक्ट पे हैं। सबसे पहला मेरा इंट्रोडक्टरी प्रेजेंटेशन प्रोफेसर पटेल ने किया था चेयर, सो मैं इनके प्रति शुक्रगुजार हूँ। दूसरा जो था जो पिछले साल दिसंबर में हुआ, वो रमा शंकर सिंह ने किया, सो मैं उनके प्रति भी शुक्रगुजार हूँ। और आज जो CN सर हैं, सुबू सर, जो कि मेरे ख्याल मोस्ट कॉम्पिटेंट पर्सन मुझे लगे इसको चेयर करने के लिए, खासकर मेरे फाइनल प्रेजेंटेशन को, और ऑब्वियसली उन्होंने ये साबित किया, सो आई एम ग्रेटफुल टू यू सर आल्सो। और मैं बाकी के जो दो मेरे चेयर रहे, मैं उनके प्रति भी, जो मेरी दो अलग अलग प्रेजेंटेशन हुई, एक प्रेजेंटेशन मेरी ऑटोबायोग्राफी पे थी, उसमें रोहित सर, क्योंकि उन्होंने भी अपनी ऑटोबायोग्राफी लिखी है, तो उन्होंने चेयर किया था और बड़ा अच्छा एक्सपीरियंस था वो भी, सो मैं आई एम ग्रेटफुल टू यू प्रोफेसर पुरोहित। एंड एक गांधी पे मैंने एक लेक्चर किया था, उसमें प्रोफेसर MP सिंह चेयर कर रहे थे, और इनके इनसाइट्स मेरे लिए हमेशा यूजफुल होते हैं, और इनकी काफ़ी सारी धारणाएं भी हैं, काफ़ी सारे अपने नज़रिए, अपने विचार भी हैं, तो कई बार हम मतभेद भी होते हैं हमारे, लेकिन फिर भी इनसे बहुत कुछ सीखने को मिलता रहा है मुझे। और साथ ही मैं कुछ लोगों के नाम और लेना चाहूँगा जिनसे मुझे बहुत कुछ सीखने को मिला, काफ़ी इंसाइट्स मिले। मैं यहाँ अगेन अपने डायरेक्टर सर का नाम लूँगा कि ये हर एक प्रेजेंटेशन में, हर एक मौके पे जो ये अपनी बातें करते हैं, तो नो डाउट इज रियली एन एकेडमिक लीडर, दो आइडियोलॉजिकली और एकेडमिकली हमारे काफ़ी डिफरेंसेज हैं और वो रहेंगे, क्योंकि ये कहते हैं कि ही इज ए कंजर्वेटिव, दो आई डोंट बिलीव दैट ही इज ए कंजर्वेटिव मैन, आई ऑलवेज क्लेम दैट ही इज ए गांधियन, एंड इन दैट सेंस इज क्लोज टू मी। एंड मैं थोड़ा सा सोशल रिवोल्यूशनरी मानता हूँ, अपने आप को रेडिकल मानता हूँ, मैं फूले की परंपरा में हूँ, तो इनके प्रति, इनसे काफ़ी कुछ सीखने को मिला। इसके अलावा कुछ और जो सीनियर फेलोज थे, उन्होंने भी मुझे बहुत कुछ सिखाया। मैं मैडम सुजाता पटेल का नाम लेना चाहूँगा, जो मेरे बगल में ही रहती थी, शी इज़ ए ग्रेट सोशियोलॉजिस्ट एंड ग्रेट ग्रेट सोशल साइंटिस्ट, और उनसे बहुत सारे इंसाइट्स मुझे मिलते रहे, अर्लियर स्टेज में कई महीने हम दोनों साथ रहे। इसी तरह एक मैडम रेखा चौधरी, जो जम्मू कश्मीर से आती हैं, उनसे कई चीज़ें, बहुत सारी चीज़ें सीखी मैंने। और मैडम रेखा चौधरी की एक बात तो मैं खासकर यहाँ मेंशन कर ही देता हूँ, उन्होंने कहा कि किसी न किसी तरह की मार्जिनलिटी को पकड़ ही लेना चाहिए, आदमी जो है तब सच तक पहुंचता है, समाज के सच तक। उन्होंने कहा क्योंकि मैं तो अमीर बनिया परिवार से आती हूँ, लेकिन मैंने फेमिनिज्म को पकड़ा है, वीमेन पे काम किया, तो इसके कारण मैं चीज़ों को जान पाई, तो ये एक बहुत बड़ा इंसाइट था उनका। मैं प्रोफेसर कुलदीप भान को याद करना चाहूँगा, जो इज ए ग्रेट टावरिंग आर्कोलॉजिस्ट, और वो मुझे वहाँ बिलासपुर हाउस में, मेरे पड़ोस में भी रहते थे, तो वो काफ़ी इंसाइट्स देते थे, तो उनका बीच में ऐसे जाना, वो भी बड़ा हमें हमेशा एक तरह से चुभता रहेगा। अंजलि दुहान का मैं नाम लूँगा, मेरे हरियाणा से ही आती हैं और जब मैं IIS में आया, सबसे पहले जिस फेलो से मेरी बात हुई थी वो मैडम अंजलि दुहानी थी। टेलीफोनिकली हमारी बातें हुई, इनको मेरे बारे में जब पता चला तो इन्होंने खुद फ़ोन किया, ये मुझे जानती नहीं थी। और उसके बाद हम दोनों के बहुत ही मधुर संबंध रहे हैं और आपस में हम खाना पीना भी शेयर करते हैं, कई चीज़ें हैं और आइडियाज़ भी। तो अंजलि, आई एम ग्रेटफुल टू यू ऑल्सो। डॉक्टर प्रसन्नजीत जो कि अभी रिसेंटली मेरे रूममेट हुए, बड़े सोशोलॉजिस्ट हैं, उनका धन्यवाद दूंगा मैं। उससे पहले जो श्रीलंका से एक फेलो थी वो लड़की, डॉक्टर क्या, हाँ निमी, तो निमी से मैंने, मेरी काफ़ी डिस्कशन हुई है, उसमें श्रीलंकन सोसाइटी के बारे में बहुत सारी चीज़ें मुझे बताई और बताया कि वहाँ भी जो है कास्ट प्रॉब्लम कितनी ज़्यादा हॉरिबल रूप में रही है। आदिल का मैं शुक्रगुजार हूँ। इसके अलावा यहाँ हिमाचल प्रदेश यूनिवर्सिटी के भी कई लोग थे जिनसे मैंने काफ़ी सीखा, जैसे प्रोफेसर सिकंदर कुमार हैं जो कि वाइस चांसलर हैं हिमाचल यूनिवर्सिटी के, वो मेरे काफ़ी क्लोज लोगों में से हैं। मैं BK शिवरम का खासकर नाम लेना चाहूँगा जो हिस्ट्री डिपार्टमेंट को हेड कर रहे हैं, और मेरी जो ऑटोबायोग्राफी पे उन्होंने काफ़ी अपने कमेंट्स दिए और खासकर इसका टाइटल फाइनल करने में उन्होंने मेरी बड़ी सहायता करी थी। इसके अलावा स्टाफ में 2000 लोगों के खासकर मैं नाम लेना चाहूँगा, रविंदर सैनी जो कि शुरू से ही मुझे गाइड करते रहे हैं, डायरेक्टर के PA हैं, और उनसे जब भी मैंने फ़ोन किया हमेशा मुझे मेरी प्रॉब्लम सॉर्ट आउट की। मैडम विजय लक्ष्मी मैडम हैं, रितिका देवराज जो कि मैस में हैं, विजय जो यहीं पे हम सबको ये सारा लाइव सेमिनार करवाते हैं, और इसके अलावा जो सब स्टाफ है उसमें खासकर मैं बलीराम का नाम जरूर लेना चाहूँगा जो कि हमेशा मुझे मिलते हैं, जो स्वीपर हैं यहाँ पे और काफ़ी जो है डाउन ट्रोडन बैकग्राउंड से आते हैं, उनकी एक प्रॉब्लम भी थी मैंने डायरेक्टर के सामने रखी। तो पूरे स्टाफ से मुझे हमेशा जो है पूरा कोऑपरेशन मिला, पूरा सम्मान मिला, पूरा एनकरेजमेंट मिला। सो आई फाइनली IIAS को सैल्यूट करूंगा। थैंक यू।
सुभजी, जस्ट वन वर्ड
प्लीज।
आई एम ओवरवेल्म्ड। चहल साहब आपने क्या कर दिया, A to Z सबके नाम ले लिए, जैसे कि फेयरवेल हो रही है आपको। ये आपकी फेयरवेल नहीं है सर, अभी तो बहुत फ्रेटर्निटी के लिए मौका मिलेगा।
ओके सर,
लेकिन
थैंक यू।
आई जस्ट वांट टू से वन थिंग कि मैं अपने तहे दिल से ये कहना चाहता हूँ, चहल साहब आपके यहाँ आने से एनर्जी कुछ बदल गई, अच्छी हुई, बेहतर हुई, and we all appreciate you, we appreciate your presence, and aaj ka discussion to bahut hi acha raha mere liye bhi, I also learnt a lot, to hum chahte hain ki aapka kaam bahut acha ho, and just as we are citing Polly O'Hanlon, she will have to cite you, this is my ambition for you. So thank you very much. बट इतने आपने इतनी फेयरवेल कर दी, इससे मुझे थोड़ा सा दुख हुआ आज कि आज ही आपने सब
वैसे सर आप भी जो रिमार्क कर रहे हैं फेयरवेल वाले ही
आपने शुरू किया आपने। अच्छा, आप लोगों की चाय और बहुत अच्छा आपके लिए पकोड़े हैं, वो ठंडे हो रहे हैं, प्लीज ले लीजिए। बाय।
थैंक यू।
थैंक यू
सर के साथ।